All right. So we just had E3, happened on Sunday. And we'll just hop in with EA, who changed up their schedule. They basically did their normal thing. It was just on Sunday this time instead of, it's like on Monday, midday. So
yeah,
we had,
no, that's
bad. Yeah. So we had EA, we'll do it this way. So EA started off with Titanfall 2. They showed
right.
off.
Which looks great.
Yeah, looks really good. Not only did they show off single player, but they did also show off some multiplayer. No actual like gameplay demos, but you know trailers. And a few things I jotted down about that Titanfall that kind of stood out. So there are now 6 new Titans. We got a name for the Titan that wields a sword that is called a Ronin, which
is
awesome.
That
is the
perfect name.
Yeah, they
for that.
Really,
yes.
They have done a very good job with their names. I was thinking they're just going to go with like the generic Berserker because that's what everyone would call something like that.
Too easy.
Yeah, exactly. That's too easy. So I would have been a bit disappointed but not surprised if that was the case. But I was very happy with Ronin. I want to say the generic one I think is called Atlas, right? And then tankier one is an Ogre and the faster one is a Strider. And so they
been
have
a while since I played, but I think that's right.
Yeah, I know I'm right on Strider and Ogre. I'm pretty confident Atlas is the main one, but I don't remember for sure. But yeah, they definitely do a good job with naming their mechs and not being just cliche obvious names. But at the same time,
you
still
Ronin,
know
I,
what
I
that
happy.
Means. Yeah. And then they showed off some other ones too. But we don't know a whole lot about them. This one, it seems like the mechs are really going to have more personality. I mean, they definitely, in Titanfall 1, they had different voices that had different personalities to them. But now it's really going to go a lot more into almost being their own characters. Which could be cool. It seemed, when I was watching the trailers, it seemed like it flowed very well.
I'm fine with that.
Yeah,
I mean,
so
you know, my biggest thing is just the fact that it finally has a single player. That was
yeah,
the one thing that pissed me off.
That's what a lot of people are very excited about. I'm not sure how long the single player will be, but I'm very happy to, you know, finally get some story and some information. Hopefully they'll touch up on a few things.
Hours, that's fine.
Yeah. Yeah, oh yeah. I mean, as long as it's at least like an 8-hour campaign, that's fine. I just don't want it to be like a 4-hour campaign.
Right, exactly.
But then a huge thing was grappling hooks. And I've always enjoyed grappling hooks in the games through the past. They've just been a feature I've very much enjoyed in most of my shooters. And then I was really sold at the very end of the trailer when two pilots eject out of their mechs and then one guy grapple hooks the other one and like basically pulls himself into him and then just like kicks him and kills him. Like that was a really awesome scene and I'm going to definitely
imagine
be trying to do
match
that
because of something like that.
What was that?
I said, imagine winning a match because of a situation like that. I mean, that's cool.
If they have some kind of like kills of the game or something and yeah, you could get a replay of that, that'd be awesome. Happy got on. He'll probably come hop in here.
Awesome.
But also they did say that the campaign is going to be able to be played offline, which is a big deal. Yeah, Happy, we are doing the podcast. We just started, so just make your audio available. We're not really playing a game.
All right. Where's everybody else?
Yeah, you know. They don't.
What about Vault's on?
Yeah, but he's playing Rainbow. Everyone else is too busy playing their games to come talk about E3 with us.
I mean, this is a pretty important week gamers. In gaming.
Yeah, you know, it is a pretty important week. You would think people would want to talk about point. E3. But,
this is really the week to
do it. I
figured
this would be the time to talk.
Yeah, no.
Yeah,
Force and Neo are too busy playing Overwatch. Vault's on Rainbow, so, yeah. You know, in accidents, like, I don't have an opinion. So people don't really,
Everybody has an opinion, he just doesn't want to voice it.
Well, I don't... He probably didn't watch E3, though. Like, he probably knows very little about E3, so he doesn't...
What's this with the crew? Is the crew... Oh, try the crew for free, so it's not...
No, the crew is a game with gold, isn't it?
No, it says try it free.
Oh, well, okay. Anyway, so continuing on, so basically, Happy, what I'm gonna do is I'm just reading off of what happened at E3 and just butt in when you have something to contribute. We just started with EA and Titanfall 2, and then also they did mention that all the DLC will be free. Which it's definitely a growing trend. A lot of games are doing that, at least with the maps. Many games these days are giving us free updates and they're throwing in some free maps because they realize that paid maps kind of divides the community. So I'm very happy that Titanfall 2 is going to do free DLC. They ended up doing that in the first game. They were like, all right, guys, no one's really buying this. So here, take this DLC.
Choice. Wow, that's good for them that they made it free. I mean, I don't think they made it permanently free. I don't know if they did or not.
I don't know if they did or not, because I had that. I had already paid for it.
I remember there was
that
time frame at one point.
But yeah, it definitely was free for...
It was a good game. No, I think it was a great game. I just think I don't even know why we stopped playing it, to be honest.
I think other games came out. You know, that's what happens. Other games come out and we play other things.
It just gets in the way. And then you come back to it a year later and you're like, why did I stop this?
Yeah, well, I definitely like it. I know part of it also was like... I think a lot of the community didn't like... They felt like they didn't have enough of a reward for playing... So, like, it kind of just, the drive to keep playing kind of went away fast.
Well, I guess, I guess there isn't such a prestige type thing. There wasn't, like, you know, Call of Duty where...
Yeah, there was prestige, but there was just no purpose
like
of prestige. 1,000
hours, yeah.
Like, the only purpose was...
You get this emblem if you play your like, for a month straight.
Yeah, so that's...
Yeah, that was me with Destiny. I just, you know, it was really fun for such a long time, but eventually I just got tired.
Yep.
Yeah.
And then
it was good while it lasted.
Yeah, so that's all I got on Titanfall 2, which is slated for the end of October, which is awesome, October 28th. So that will be a nice start of the fall season games. And then real quick, you know, as every year EA does their sports, and it was
like three quarters of the presentation.
They put a lot into it, and it's like every year it's just very uninteresting to me.
You're not
the
alone.
One thing that stood out that I again not really interesting to me, but cool that they're doing something new. FIFA is actually going to have a campaign story, so yay.
Wait, what do you mean, like, campaign story? I didn't
ever heard for sports.
Campaign story, kind of like, is it going to be
similar
to, like,
how Raw? You're
going
to play as a character,
Raw?
And you're going to
like WWE
kick the
Raw?
Ball around. I don't know what to tell you.
Well, you know how wrestling kind of had a campaign kind of like that?
Yeah, wrestling's definitely have campaigns.
Yeah, mm-hmm. But I mean, like, most of the time for FIFA, it's like, it's more or less you play kind of franchise mode, or you play as, like, you know, kind of... You know, the stockholder of a team or something, and you basically, you know, you do have a certain team.
Yeah, well, this one I'm pretty sure there is an actual character, probably a fictional character
dialogue with other people
that will have, and I think they're going to try to have, like, you know, dialogue. Emotions and stuff like that in this game.
Interesting.
I think, yeah. And then also. EA really kind of was pushing that they're trying to get more into esports, and so they're gonna have much more competition stuff going on for their just all their EA games, not just the sports. But they're really trying to be more competitive for that. No problem.
Oh, hey.
So
have a recent
All right, I'll catch you up on this vault. So we're, you know, we're just
That's okay. Don't worry about it.
No. Are you going to stay around or no?
For a little bit. Yeah, but I'm just
Well, anyway,
I'll weave my way back in.
Mass Effect.
Yes.
Yeah, they didn't show a lot.
Sorry for that belting.
they gave us a little bit, but basically what we've learned is they're going to use the Frostbite engine, so it's going to look beautiful.
Is this Justin?
And they did say we're going to learn more about Mass Effect in the fall. So I'm not sure exactly
Gamescom
when I don't know if that I count that as fall. So I don't know if that's
doesn't
what their
Gamescom
plan is
happen
not.
In October or what am I thinking?
I
of
thought
that
Gamescom was August if
thing?
I was remembering right, but I might
What's
be wrong.
What's that thing that happens in Europe and
a part of Europe?
I thought wrestling in it because you done the WWE.
No, I forget which one.
No, happy because I can't get EA access to work. Oh no, that's not EA access, is it? No.
No, it's not.
No,
anyways,
you're right. Thanks,
I was.
Thanks for reminding
apparently
me
hadn't
that,
heard.
Do that.
Apparently, it had been leaked, but yeah. I had never even heard that there was going to be a Dead Rising 4. So I was surprised as hell when
it
they
had
announced Dead Rising
4. It had gotten leaked earlier in the day, supposedly. Or maybe the day before. It, it
oh,
was
I thought
not
they were talking about like well
leak.
Before that. Like I hadn't heard about that.
It was not well
no,
before.
No, the leak hadn't sprung until the recent.
It,
hours
and it wasn't a very strong leak, but we're going to get into that later. We're going. In order.
Oh my God! You and your
all
orders.
I
like to be organized.
You and
I'm
your
sorry.
Orders. Oh my
it
God!
Makes things
your
much simpler.
Order 66.
Anyway.
I don't really feel like it.
Anyone got anything else to say on Mass Effect?
More.
One. More.
Get makes him Mass Effect.
Okay. So we're moving on.
I'm just glad they're going back to exploration.
The game I was very like excited about was. It's spelled F-E. I think it's pronounced Fee or Fay. Fee.
Oh yeah, the platformer. Right?
Yeah, so it's like a 3D platformer. It's basically one of those artsy, beautiful, beautiful art style and beautiful soundtrack. It's not going to be pushing the limits for anything, but it will be a fun little art. They don't like to use the word arcade games anymore, but that's what it is. It's an arcade game.
It looks like it has a lot of potential, actually.
I think it does.
In such an early stage.
It's definitely right up my alley. I mean, here I am. I have Ori as my background. Like, that's the kind of games I like. Ori. This Faye in particular reminded me very much of... Never Alone, in the sense that it dealt with a lot of like spirit animals kind of things, and so I'm excited for it. It looks cool. It also kind of had a reminiscence of Tearaway, just kind of the art style. That looked interesting to me. I'm excited for it. Mm-hmm. I was very upset with the fact that they threw Star Wars in there. Because it honestly just shouldn't have even been thrown in there. Because they showed a lot of nothing at all, and they presented it in a way like you were getting something, and it was just upsetting.
Yeah,
because they basically
they
just like had developers
like,
talk
it made
about
since
it.
So last sad. E3. Last E3,
well, last
knew, hey,
E3 they showed
bringing
things.
Star Wars back.
They're like, hey guys,
well,
here's
and it was for Battlefront, which was awesome.
But
at
this
the time,
one, they're like, hey guys, we're working on like 3 different Star Wars games. We're not going to really show anything, and we're not going to even mention any names. But here's some quick looks at things that you've seen before and people talking.
And John Williams soundtrack.
So that was.
They could have just had someone come out to the stage and there's just the like three words, Star Wars makes money. And like that'd be it. And then
right.
They just leave.
It's like
claps.
The Kingdom Hearts 3.
And yet, in 3 years, we've only released one Star Wars game.
If they
game.
Came
welcome,
out
guys.
And just said, we are working on, and they dropped a name, that would have been excellent. That would have been far superior to what we saw. It wouldn't, you know, I still would have been like, oh man, I want more. But it wouldn't have been the
They're
trash
gonna be movie
that
tie-ins.
We saw.
They're Lucas would have been tie-ins. More fulfilled with that, with them saying that, and then a child's drawing of Star Wars than what they
Yes.
did.
Yes. I really would have.
I would play a child's drawing of Star Wars.
And then they ended it strong with Battlefield 1. And Battlefield 1, I'm very excited for, but with how bad Battlefield 4's launch was, I am worried. With
Maybe
Battlefield 4, I couldn't play the game for 2 months. It just was not
Which,
playable
speaking
for
of,
2 months.
Speaking of, it's on sale right now for $450.
I don't care. I don't want it anymore.
You can get it for free. Line,
same price.
Well, yeah, I don't want it anymore.
People who don't have it.
I can't
believe one thing
you.
Is like surprised is that they like, didn't give anything free for EA Access. Not that they really had a bunch to give away. But
that was, you know, that
I
was a surprise.
Were gonna, sure.
You know, we were guessing it was gonna be what were Unravel or Plants vs Zombies
yeah,
or
Unravel
Star Wars.
Be...
We were thinking
yeah.
Star Wars
Unravel
a lot.
Was nice.
Unravel was good, and that they did mention Unravel right before they started talking about Faye. Just you know, just try to. Bring
I
them
really
together.
It was gonna be Garden. Well, no, Garden Warfare is still too early, so no.
Yeah.
Or it could have been but, a game like Faye. Get and for EA Access members, you're getting this for free. Like.
Or they could have just announced
Faye
yeah,
3. Yeah, they really didn't. They didn't really push any more EA Access. But yeah, Battlefield
well,
One.
I mean,
you know,
yeah.
World War One. Beautiful yeah. graphics. I honestly, I want to see more trench warfare because that's World War One. And we haven't seen anything like that. I don't know if they're gonna stay away from it.
Oh, I want it. I want it. Because
to be honest,
I want
like
I want
having
gas.
Having
gas
a successful World War One shooter will not be easy. They're gonna have to stretch the imagination a bit, and they're gonna have to be their own creative people. They're not
the
gonna
the
be
toy
able to...
soldiers did well, Anubis. Just think about it. I mean, it's not exact comparison, but World War
I
One
mean,
games can work.
Yeah, that's... Kind of.
That's
kind
a very
of,
different
kind of
comparison.
It. Well, it's still.
You can say,
yes.
How about
the
Darkness?
Developers
the Darkness
that
had a World War
very,
One sequence.
That is a vastly different
I'm
game.
Just saying, it's not like it hasn't been done in the past, is all I'm saying.
No, I know. Vault. It's like saying, you know, the Hearts game.
Kingdom Hearts.
Valiant Hearts.
Kingdom Hearts.
No.
Valiant Hearts.
Oh.
Valiant Hearts. Like,
oh, okay. Valiant
Hearts. Yeah. Valiant Hearts.
Yeah.
World War
yeah.
One game.
That, yeah.
That doesn't make more sense in this conversation.
The
that's the same comparison. Like, you're comparing a
well,
platformer
you made it sound like no
shooter.
One's ever done a World War One game is what it basically sounded like.
No.
And I was like,
but to have a successful first-person shooter on the... Basically competing head-to-head with Call of Duty... That is going
to
be very hard
Went
if you want
future.
To stay true to World War One, and so they're not going to be able to do that. They have to have their own reimaginings, which I'm not sure. I mean, I don't know. I like older guns and stuff, so I think I'll still have fun with it. My biggest concern is just that if it's going to work.
I like
it's
that
a fair
they're gonna do it.
Thing to be worried
it will
about.
Work.
Honestly,
yeah.
In fact. What's going to be most interesting is how well the campaign is. That's what I'm most excited about.
I'm, you know, I would
care less
I would
about
be very excited for that. I'm
I could care
I
less
know.
About multiplayer cuz
it's
I don't know.
EA so yeah. I am worried.
I'm more like you. I gravitate away from multiplayer more and more.
Yeah.
Mainly cuz of other
especially
people
especially with
online.
Battlefield, I've
Oh yeah,
gravitated
with the shooter community.
Away from it.
Which is why he loves Battlefront so much.
Oh yeah, I love Battlefront so much nowadays. Just right. The more I play it, the
campaign.
Less I like it.
All right, and any more about the EA conference?
No.
All right.
I'm probably not going to be here this
game?
Whole thing if
Less
we're going to do this so
Star
slowly.
Wars.
I'm probably not going to be here this whole podcast if we're going to do it this slowly. All right.
But then stop interrupting.
No offense, no offense. Just
then stop Ooh. Talking.
Fault.
So,
Fault's
Bethesda.
Like, okay.
We got... Bethesda, they opened up strong with, I liked, they had a little text thing, and you know they hid some clues in there. There's rumors of a new Wolfenstein game hidden in that little text they had.
Yep.
But then they spelled out Quake, which, like, that was one of those things people are just, like, talking about, like, what if this happened? Like, no one really expected that to happen. That was more of just a dream guess. Like
that one guy kept jumping up and down.
After thing we do, I kind of guessed it.
You felt like they were going in the direction of Quake.
Was that they did not announce it for consoles? They said only PC, which was incredibly surprising.
Yeah,
that they would limit the market.
The last Quake was PC only as well.
No, but Vault, that was at a different time, though.
Yeah, but it was still
during 360.
I mean,
it was during 360.
Not common. It's still not common for an E3 presentation to announce something PC only.
Yeah, it is very uncommon.
I don't think it's that uncommon.
Okay, go find me some PC only releases.
Wasn't what was that one game? The first game initially that was PC only.
The first PC only game?
No! They those games. Then
not
Vault's in trouble thinking of it. Why don't you think of other examples?
Crisis. The first Crisis was PC only initially.
How long ago are you talking about now?
That was
back
like
in the 360 days.
Did they even
2007, 2008?
Like that was earlier than that. But okay.
And did they even announce it? Did
so
they announce
in the last
it at
10
E3?
Years, you can't think of an example.
I don't even think they announced it at E3 either. So Vault's probably like.
And who knows if they announced
that. I'm not blowing bubbles out. Crisis was.
I don't know if they announced that at E3 or not. But, anyway, so Quake Champions.
There is no definitely not if
an
you don't
arena
know.
Arena shooter. And then they went on to, and, you know, I guess it's making money, but it just, it's a genre that I just have absolutely no interest in. They announced Elder Scrolls Online Legends.
Yeah,
the card game.
Mobile card game.
The card game. So
and
yeah,
it's gonna be available on Windows, Android, iOS devices as long as PC.
Yeah. I don't really have much. I mean, they're like, hey, it's gonna have its own campaign and stuff, but like, I don't.
It's another thing that's only PC only, but that's different. Card games, I can imagine.
That's different. That's a new. It's a new genre that's sprouting right now. So then we also had some talk about the Fallout DLC looking pretty good. They had the that creative stuff where you can just make your own Rube Goldberg devices.
Vault as well.
And then I think that might have been a separate one though. I couldn't tell, but I think that was actually a separate DLC where you can create your own vault. But that's really cool. And then there was something about like a Nuka-Cola theme park. Looking thing,
yeah,
and that looked really cool too. And
yeah, props for Fallout.
I was surprised how much they talked about the virtual reality coming to Fallout. I thought that was pretty interesting.
Oh yeah,
I was kind of surprised.
I'm moving the subject along, but
I'm kind of surprised how much Guns Blazing Bethesda came out with. I thought if they were gonna talk about virtual reality,
I don't actually think Bethesda talked about that. I think that was in the PS4 conference.
It was announced for Fallout and Doom.
Oh yeah, they did. Yeah, never mind.
Right. No, you're right.
Wasn't there a third game that they announced it for, or was it just those two?
I think it was just
Fallout
that.
And Doom.
Yeah, it was just those two. It was just those two.
And that's interesting.
Can we talk about Dishonored?
Hold on, no, I'm getting there. You made me lose my. There was Fallout. Oh, you made me lose my train of thought. Stupid.
We were talking about virtual reality.
Fallout
DLC. Then we went to virtual reality.
I was
going to
say something. I don't know what. Anyway.
They talked about Doom some more after that. And then.
They talked a little bit about.
People
DLC.
Can play the first level of Doom for free right now.
Yep. They made it so that everyone can play the first level of Doom. That's really cool. Try to help draw people to that game.
Doom
get them
fun.
A chance to try
so
it.
So much fun.
They did announce a bunch of updates as well that are coming that are going to be free, which is pretty cool. And then they also did talk about some of the premium DLC. It was very exciting, although, it's a game that I actually, there was a rumor about and I was like, no, that's a dumb rumor and I don't want it to happen anyway. But now that it is a thing, I need to buy it. Skyrim got a remake. And yes, you know, it's Skyrim, so I want it
remastered.
Yeah.
It's
cool that it's going to have mod support.
I'm not upset. I'll say this. I'm not upset, but back of my mind was really hoping they were going to do Morrowind. Really was hoping they were going to do Morrowind.
That's fine. I don't need it right now. Whenever it goes on sale, you know, I'll buy it cheap.
Yeah.
You know, that's my thought process. Like, hey,
it'll
whenever
be around.
It's cheaper, you
it'll
know,
always
around 15
be around.
Bucks,
and it's, it's what sucks. I mean, I kind of understand to a certain extent why they're doing it, but it sucks if you've bought all the DLC from the PC, you're getting it for free, essentially.
Well, to be honest, I don't think they mentioned anything about it having all the DLCs. No, did they confirm?
Yes, they
did.
They said if you bought all the DLC for Skyrim through, I think they said through through Steam, that you get the game for free, the remastered version for free.
Oh, I didn't hear that. But okay.
Yeah, I did read confirmation of that.
And people are bitching about how, well, I bought it on 360 or PS3. Why am I not getting it? And I mean, people are like saying,
"Well,
because
is it really
that
hard to understand?"
It's kind of a cheap move, but I understand why they're doing it. It's kind of a cheap move.
Yeah, but it's nice that it's gonna be there as an option. I don't know if I'll buy that at launch or not. Depends what other games are gonna be keeping me busy.
I don't think so, because it's gonna go down in price, and then I'll have other games. But that's just me.
Well, every game goes down in price.
Yeah, yeah.
The difference here is that Skyrim we've already played.
Nintendo games go up in price somehow.
They didn't announce an official price point, did they?
Nintendo breaks that barrier.
No, I don't think they did.
Some people are thinking 60. I'm thinking it's probably going to be 40, but no one's really confirmed anything.
I'm thinking it's going to be.
I'm aware of. That's what I'm asking.
I think with all the time it's been out, but who knows?
I would think 40, but. Yeah, it's possible they might try to go for that 60 price point because
it's
Skyrim.
They'll say, well, you're getting all the DLC and you're getting mods.
Well, no. We'll see.
But you're giving it to PC gamers for free. Like, so are you really going to charge $60 when you're giving it to for free to PC gamers?
Right.
That would be really just a cheap move.
Well, we'll see. Arcane Studios came out to talk, and I got excited because I was excited for Dishonored 2, but they actually announced their new game that they've been working on, which is Prey.
I can't believe it's really happening.
I never played the first Prey. This
Not
one looks
excited.
Pretty cool. A lot of people are like, well, it doesn't really look like Prey, but at the same time, it's we haven't been shown much, and there's only been one other Prey.
I love psychological games.
I love the first one. The first one was so much fun.
Yeah, definitely play the first one.
This kind of has me nervous.
It's a must play.
Yeah, if you remember just being able to run off
what's
on
the
sides
genre?
And whatnot, that was so much fun. It was. Yeah. It was a first-person shooter / puzzle solver. Would that be a fair assumption?
That's good enough for
me. Yeah, you could call it
like
a psychological
thriller. They did a very interesting.
Yeah, like is it
a
horror?
Interesting way of using gravity.
No,
not really scary.
Not real. Okay.
Not really scary.
That demo didn't look too scary. It looked a little scary. I mean, it looked scary and psychological.
It'll mess with your head, but it's not scary.
Yeah, well, I mean, because you guys keep saying psychological.
What was really fun
was
when you had like these. What was so fun about
Prey? I mean, psychological and in a way is kind of a genre of horror in you, but it's just not. It's not as obviously, hey, I'm gonna slaughter this person. It's more like, you know,
what was
psychologically
what was, like its heart. What's its core was its gravity, like manipulation, especially when you had these tiny planets and you'd be like in this big room and there's this little tiny planet. You'd be running around trying to fight enemies, like you're upside down and literally.
Well, that sounds cool.
And it just it was really fun. That was what made Prey so much fun.
I might have to look into that.
And they did that in multiplayer too, and that was what also made it fun. But
a few things
I
want to.
That's why I'm just not looking forward to these Preys.
A few things I want to point out about this Prey is they did mention you're on a space station overrun by aliens. You were like some kind of experiment, so you have like mind bending powers, and we're gonna learn more about. That at QuakeCon, along with obviously Quake.
Sounds about right.
Some of the other
stuff.
It
almost looked kind of like the theory, what if you were in a simulation type thing? Like it's a human in a simulation, and then he's realizing he's no longer in a simulation. It kind of looked almost like that for a little bit.
Kind of like that movie you had us watch recently, Happy.
But
you know how you can theorize that hey, this is all a simulation, and we're really just being like, you know, aliens are really just, you know, just like the one we were watching earlier.
Yeah,
kind of like
Dave.
That.
Don't do it. What was his name again? It wasn't Dave. What was it?
Well, except that he was actually trapped in a certain thing, but imagine, like, we're hooked up to a machine, and it's kind of like the Matrix type thing where, you know, this is just like a fake world and we're hooked up to a machine. It kind of looks something like the Matrix.
I can't protect you if you go outside, Dave.
I'm afraid I can't let you do that, Dave.
But, yeah, so it looks cool. I can't wait to see some kind of gameplay on it. And people were really excited for it. I mean, Bethesda had some strong hitting, and they didn't really get leaked. I'm very impressed with Bethesda on that. Their stuff did not get leaked.
Are you kidding me? There have been rumors that there was going to be a Prey announced.
Yeah, but
there
that's not a leak.
There were serious rumors that Skyrim was going to be getting a remake.
Yeah, there's rumors.
Skyrim was getting remaked.
There's no proof.
There was no kind of leak about it.
Yeah, I mean, I had heard the rumor about Prey, but I took that with a grain of salt.
Yeah,
you know?
Like,
nobody
was certain there was going to be Prey.
As much salt as a, you know, bare pretzel.
But yeah, so that was really cool. They talked a little bit about Elder Scrolls Online again, but this time it was not the card game. They were just trying to promote the MMO game, and then they also released Dark Brotherhood, which is really cool. I'm glad that that's in the game.
It
I feel
looks
like that
way better
probably
than the
should
Dark
have been
Brotherhood
in the game, but...
shit. Yeah, hopefully they get the Dark Brotherhood right, because in Skyrim it was shit. I'm just saying that right now.
I love Cicero. You take that back.
Yep. But then
Skyrim, Dark Brotherhood is shit.
Actually, you know, this time around when
Dark,
I play Skyrim, I'm not
going to
kill Cicero. I'm just going to love him and let him follow me everywhere.
Yeah, I won't.
Sweet mother.
Yeah, I would definitely hive him.
Sweet
next time
mother.
I do it. But then they ended strong with Dishonored 2, which is the one I was most excited for.
Shit.
I'm a big fan of Dishonored. And
total shit.
Yeah, shut up. And a lot more people are very excited about it. A lot
of
people
of
kind of
here.
Didn't.
We're kidding when we say that.
They're not. They don't actually.
Yeah. In this particular game, we're trolling.
Because they know it looks awesome. And a lot of people give Dishonored 1 a chance.
Gave me a very strong Bioshock feel in a lot of ways.
But
I'm
you know what? Like
they
seem to really have planned out the whole... Like, they're really kind of milking Dishonored 1 for all it's worth. Because they made a... One thing is they made a remastered version for the Xbox One. They waited a year to sell that off, and now they're making it a part of the pre-order thing, and that's just like...
Well, it's only
really
a pre-order bonus for a limited time, so I don't know all the details on that.
Really
probably because there's
going to
be limited
they
editions.
They give you a digital copy.
If I was,
thing,
if
right?
I, one no, thing is, no, if no. I bought the Dishonored remastered for the Xbox One, you know, and then I'm going to buy pre-order Dishonored 2, I'd feel a little ripped off right now, being like,
well...
Well,
it's only
the
limited edition you get the...
I mean, Dishonored 1's remaster has been out for
game.
A while, so it's not like they just released it and then, like, a lot of people got it the first month, and they're like, oh, no, now a month later.
And they're only giving it
you know,
to
people
who pre-order the limited editions of Dishonored 2.
It's not the limited editions.
Not like just everyone's getting it. Really? Are they giving it to everyone?
It's for
a limited
time.
Limited edition.
I don't know the
What's
details.
What's your definition of like?
I think we all had it
time
already.
Means
so.
Until they probably run out of codes or something. I don't know.
No, you don't run out of codes, Happy. Anyway, what I really enjoyed, I thought it was just I was having a blast with my friends because Force was in the party and I had you know I was just like so excited so I was just like oh my god yay Dishonored. Something that they kept doing, which I was just having so much fun with, is about two or three times they kind of zoomed out and the guy started talking and he started explaining what we just saw about Dishonored, but in like a sum up, like a conclusion. But then he went right back and was like, and so here's more Dishonored. And I was just laughing so much because it's like, when is this gonna end? Because that went on for like 20 minutes. But they showed us a lot of really cool things. I was definitely okay with that because, like I said, that
was
the
game I was most hyped
for.
They showed us the trailer,
most hyped
which is basically everything they previously showed us with music.
They showed a little
bit
of
stuff. Yeah,
that
was kind
of
pointless, but whatever on that one. I mean, I'm still not going to complain. A few things that were really cool that I'll point out about Dishonored is you play as Corvo in Dishonored 1. You can play as him again in Dishonored 2, or you can also play as Emily. You choose one or the other in the beginning, and that's your game. So right off the bat, we already know we're going to have two different playthroughs of this game because each one has their own powers and they're going to play very differently. So that's awesome. And then
playthrough, you're gonna be super nice, and then what playthrough you're gonna be super evil. You just gotta decide which character you're gonna be nice and evil with.
Yeah,
you could do that too. Hey, for sure, we're having another podcast about E3.
Hello.
Then they also showed
off. Sure has an opinion as well.
Really
for
cool...
sure, would you like to mention?
You okay? Not you sure. Done happy? Yeah. So, something that they came out with that was just really cool, just so creative and unique, is they have this, I call it a time travel window. It's basically like this wristwatch that had some glass panes, and he was able to see past in time in this building when the building, like, because presently it's like abandoned, but back in time there were some guards walking around, and then he jumped, like he like traveled into that time that he was looking at, killed a guard, traveled back to when it was abandoned, and just through his looking glass window watched another guard like freak out that there's this dead body. And that was awesome, and so I can't wait to see what kind of cool time mechanics they use with that. But that's the Bethesda one. Anyone else got anything? Yeah, so you missed the EA and Bethesda, but now we're about to hop into Microsoft.
Only the Collector's Edition is coming Bethesda's. With the Dishonored Definitive Edition. Only the Collector's Edition, Anubis. Like I was saying.
I don't know, I'll have to look into it more, but they were not very clear
about... That
was
what they said in the E3 conference, then I just looked it up on, they're saying it comes with the Collector's Edition.
But anyway... So, then we got the Microsoft conference. They started it right off the bat with the announcement of the Slim model, which the, you know, opposite of Bethesda, pretty much half the things at Microsoft got leaked or we just knew they were going to be there anyway. So there was very little for surprises. Although there were a couple, there was very little for surprises.
Yeah, there were a few. There was enough. Expected. And a lot of people were just wanting to see a gameplay on a lot of stuff they already knew about that we hadn't gotten to see.
Yeah.
So I'm like, we got to, in addition to the surprises, we got to finally see gameplay on some games.
Yeah. But so anyway, the Slim model, it's like, I guess they're saying it's like 40% smaller. It's white.
Yeah.
It has an internal power source, so no more brick on that. And it's got up to 2 terabytes of internal memory, so it ranges from $300 to $400, depending on how much memory you want in there.
That's pretty nice.
Yeah, it's like, it's all right. It's not really needed.
It's
the
there.
Only thing people that I guess would help it sell
it,
is the
it's
fact
there.
That
What's
it's
cool.
got a 4K movie player.
Yeah, Corbin mentioned, I didn't even know that. Apparently, all 4K Blu-ray players are going for at least $400 right now.
This
will play 4K Blu-rays for $299. That's already a steal right there alone.
Yeah, well, I mean,
if you're looking for a 4K Blu-ray
player. I compare that to
Granted,
when the PS3
prices will be probably a little bit closer by this fall. Oh, yeah, I know, but I'm just throwing that out there. I mean, that is still a pretty good deal if you're just looking for 4K.
Yeah, that's like the reason to get this is if you want a good 4K player that can also play Xbox games. So that was the Slim. Then they hopped on over into games. They came out with Gears of War. Force and I did not like the demo. I was very bored. My biggest problem was I did not like the atmosphere around it. I thought it looked
like
they were in another
to try
dimension.
Too major right now.
I kind of lost interest in Gears. It just I haven't been excited for it since after 3.
Yeah,
I feel like that was it.
No,
that's
it's kind of the same way as me. I did get Judgment though, and I like Judgment, but it's
Judgment
not
for
what
beta,
it used to be.
You know, it's exactly the same.
And I did play the beta, and I still had fun. Whether or not it's the same, I still had fun, but it's not.
If it ain't broke, don't fix it. But it's still like the same.
Yeah.
I don't know.
They made some cool announcements.
Like
they did make some interesting things when they announced the whole Play Anywhere, and then they mentioned you will be able to play the co-op missions with people on PC, and I thought that was pretty interesting.
It was
thing to make.
It was Force pointed it out to me that was very key to understand. You for Gears of War, they have crossplay for the co-op features. They did not say anything about crossplay for the multiplayer, so that was
they
important.
Won't. I guarantee
that was,
you.
Yeah,
they
no,
won't.
They won't do it. But that's you know that's something that a lot of people might misunderstand.
They're doing it where they can.
And misinterpret that.
Yeah.
Is they're gonna think, oh, that means crossplay for everything? No. So it is important to know that the crossplay is
it
just for the cooperative
clear to
stuff.
Me in the
I'm telling you, people are gonna assume crossplay for everything. Anyway,
people are dumb.
People are
just, you know, they get overhyped. Sometimes you don't hear things right, and you don't really think about it. You're just oh my god. But and then Play Anywhere, they're, you know, Microsoft really trying to just help console and PC kind of.
They're giving you a better deal.
And
and
they're giving you a great deal.
Two games for the price of one.
Yep, they really are.
It's I think it's a great deal.
It's definitely
you buy the PC version or you buy the 360 version, you're getting two copies.
Yep. And then they went into Killer Instinct.
The Xbox One version, sorry.
Yeah, I got you.
Right. We know what you
mean. Killer Instinct came out and said, "Hey, General Rom is going to be in the game now." And that was exciting. Fun. I was happy to see that. I like Rom a lot.
Thank
and
God
so
it wasn't
Marcus
Phoenix.
I want to see Arbiter fight Rom now in Killer Instinct. I think that's pretty cool.
Why are they adding the secondary, the antagonists and not the protagonists?
Because they're cooler.
It would have been cool if they had given us the Queen as well, I thought. But I was very happy with General Rom. I would have preferred Rom to the Queen anyways, but putting Marcus Phoenix in there just would have been cheesy, I feel like, with the chainsaw gun and everything.
Right against all of
it just would have been cheesy as hell.
Scourge would have been a really good fighter to put in there, but he wouldn't get the attention that someone like General Rom would have gotten, so.
True.
So that was cool. And then they went into Forza Horizon 3, and that is definitely a very beautiful game. It looks like fun. You know, if you like car games, if you like Forza games, you're gonna like this. It's that simple.
Forza and Gran Turismo are pretty much the realistic racers.
Yeah.
Forza, I feel like has a
quick side note.
Gran Turismo,
I was surprised
extremely.
They did not show anything about the new Gran Turismo game on the PlayStation thing.
True.
I don't really want to get into that. I was very shocked that, you know, because that just recently got announced. I was amazed that we didn't see anything, because they've been getting killed by Forza for not having a Gran Turismo in terms of racing games. So, that shocked me. But going back to the Microsoft conference.
Horizon 3? Horizon 3? Holy shit. I have not wanted to buy a racing game this much, although I'm probably still not going to buy it. I have not wanted to buy one in a while until I saw this. This has probably gotten me the closest to wanting to buy a racing game in a while.
Yeah, it looked really cool.
Because of the exploration factor. The exploration
factor.
Yeah,
you know, being able to go off
road. What
does
really
that
cool.
anymore? I think Diddy Kong.
The last one that really did it was Underground 2. That was really good.
All the Forza Horizon games, that's what they do, is they go off roading. That's why they're Horizon numbers.
It's not
that
just
is
tracks.
The difference
it's
between
a
Horizon
tracks,
and a number for Forza is
It's not Motorsport where it's just tracks. I know I figured that out now, but it actually looks
that's
fun.
That's a nice touch.
Yeah, they're pretty cool. Some of the features they mentioned about Forza Horizon 3 is it will have for the first time a 4-player campaign co-op. Which is really cool. I guess
campaign has me curious.
Yeah, I don't know. I don't know much about racing, but so that's something. The hop in, drop in, drop out kind of co-op looked really cool, because while they were racing, one of their buddies hopped in and just got helicoptered in right into the race, and so that was really cool.
Yep.
And then announce crossplay for Forza, so that's cool too.
Play Anywhere is just coming in again, and I'm very excited
I'm liking
about
the cross
it. That's really
trend.
Cool.
Crossplay
and Play Anywhere.
In a game like this, because it only really affects shooters, where people are like, "Oh, that's not fair." But in a racer, there's no difference.
Yeah, racers and And even fighter games, I would argue, there's not a huge difference between PC and console.
It's only shooters that there's a can't mix the two.
Yeah.
Which,
by the way, I have seen some rumors about keyboard.
I mean, there's
and
been shooters in the past where it was actually really balanced. Granted, it didn't do that well. Shadowrun did it really well, for what it's worth. That was a shooter, but they really cross-platform between PC and Xbox. I mean, it can be done, but it takes a lot of balancing, and it can.
Well, definitely not always like the competitive.
It's not a norm. It's not a norm.
And then they.
It's not easy to do.
They talked to you a little bit about just like general updates coming out. Some of them were pretty cool. They talked about, you know,
Arena.
Obviously, you know, more servers and stuff and crossplay and backwards compatibility. Background music coming at some point. I don't know when. I don't want to say. I don't want to say her name because I don't want her to start listening. But the blue lady from Halo.
You have to say hey first.
Yeah, no, I'm telling you, I don't like. She's in beta right now, and I absolutely hate her. She needs so many improvements.
Well, who was it that says Quantico is that, you know, Halo 5?
Yeah, no, Quantico made an excellent point. Like, I should have known better because I've played Halo 5 and I know she's evil now. So I shouldn't have been excited for an update that involves an evil, corrupt AI. But anyway,
I really appreciate you spoiling that.
Yeah, well, you know what? Maybe you should have played Halo by now. But then I was really excited for.
But yeah, Arena
clubs,
has got me interested.
Arena,
how you can finally do tournaments a lot more easily.
Mm-hmm.
The whole Arena thing where you'll be able to do tournaments from your home a lot more frequently, it's got me really excited.
Yeah, just
it'll
like
make it
with,
so much more
just
fun
like
in
with
general.
EA, Microsoft. But is
think happy,
to get
we'll
more
be able to do hockey
scene.
Tournaments now.
Yeah,
you probably could.
I'm
you
excited
probably
for
be able
hockey
to have
tournaments
some hockey tournaments
eventually down the road.
Yeah, they may
yeah,
sound like
I'm
you can
just really excited
for your friends.
Yep, that's
yeah,
really
it,
cool.
It'll be really exciting.
Nope. I'm excited for clubs. I mean, when I hear clubs, I'm
clubs
basically
are cool
thinking
too.
Of like
I'm not sure how well
a Facebook
it's work.
Group
I'm
on a
kind of nervous about that.
Yeah, I'm not sure how well that will work either. But then also looking for group, which, you know, Destiny is a prime example of how this is very useful because Destiny. For the longest time, I think they have it now for sure. You can actually confirm this, I probably. For the longest time, they did not have a way to find a raid group. And so people went onto various websites that were not Bungie's website. And they're like, hey, I need a raid group. I think now they've made it so that you can do that on their own websites. Yeah, so now they finally caught on. But like... So situations like that now are going to be just on the console, and that's awesome. You know, there are nights where I'm like, I want to play Halo, and none of you lamos want to play with me, so that'd be awesome. I could be like, hey, I want to play Halo.
Lamo, that's a strong word.
Yeah. and all
lame-o's
of that is supposed
Halo.
To come.
Those hate words
all of
on
that
us.
Is supposed to come. This
hey, that could
fall.
Work.
And so I'm excited for that this fall. Then they went into, and this was, in my opinion, the worst part of the conference. They went into talking about Minecraft and some new features that they have on their tablets and their PC. They did not mention the console.
$1 billion investment. They gotta cover it.
I understand they put
they
a lot of money.
They put $2 billion
what upsets me is they didn't like.
Oh,
this would have been
four.
Something interesting if it was on console,
well, it
but it
four.
Wasn't even for the consoles that they were talking. And so
pales in comparison to 26 billion for
that's why I don't like that is because you know if it was on the console itself then that's something but it wasn't it was the tablet and PC so not and
well,
and
they were just trying
just
to show
the presenters.
How it's eventually going to be where everyone can play together whether you're on Xbox or PC or anything is what they're trying to push
they're trying to push
so I
kind of
see how they showed
they,
it but that really
but
shouldn't
now,
have been there
there's
it
no talk
be,
about
in
it
the
on console
well they just shouldn't have had it on
it also
conference.
Probably could have been better if they have just better presenters. I just the three people they
yeah,
had
they,
were
they,
very awkward and just
yeah,
not
really
pleasurable
great.
To listen to. Like it was painful some of their jokes and stuff. So that was the down that was the low point of their presentation. But then they went into custom controllers, which I personally am not very excited for, but a lot of people are. So yeah, I'm not gonna bash
fully customizable controller.
$80, $90 if you want engravings.
It's like when you get a new.
Oh, is it $90 if you want engraving?
Yeah, that's what I was told. It's an extra $10 for an engraving. That's what I was told by someone.
You know, people who can't hold the normal controller in the same way. I can see that benefiting.
I think it's just colors, though.
Is it?
Yeah. It's a mirror image of iPods. You know, like you have blue, pink, purple, yellow, red, and so you can mix and match.
Oh, okay.
They were claiming
there's over 8 million different controllers
things you can have, which is insane. So you can have you can have like 8 different colors to choose from. But it's cool.
There's some parts have a limited collection of colors versus others you can choose from, depending on what part you're looking at.
Yeah.
But that's good.
Yeah, every choice has at least 4 or 5 different kinds
to choose
from.
Blue controller at the stores and stuff.
Mm-hmm.
Change it.
Yep. My issue with it is that there aren't designs. If I could have done some kind of designs, like the engraving is, in my opinion, is what's really cool. If I could have done some kind of like designs, like made it a Halo one or something, that's what would have sold me on it. But hey, you know, work in progress.
It would have been nice if we could have.
They do have websites.
I know, I know. But we're talking about this presentation. Like I've already got a Master Chief controller. I'm good. I'm just saying, for example. They could. That's what would have made
me
happy.
They would
have
gone back to what they did with 360 days with the customizable faceplates, like only for the controller. That would have been nice.
Yeah.
Kind of still sad they went away from that.
And then
I'd rather have a controller to be custom from like the core, not something you just snap on.
Yeah. No, that's true. No, that's what he's saying. That's what he's saying. He does. He's glad that.
No, I'd rather. I like.
And it's,
true.
I'm just saying it would have been nice if we could in some cases, like similar to how they did with the 360 in the early days with the front plate of the 360, where you could just customize it.
I do miss that. That
would look
cool.
Like.
Oh, you mean the faceplate?
He means the faceplate of the console itself.
Yeah, I said the faceplate.
Yeah,
that was fun.
Yeah, that I thought that was.
Yeah, cool. And then they went away, and it was just sad.
But and then they announced this is a big indie title here. They talked about it, but they didn't show anything, and it comes out at the end of this month, which was insane. But then they showed off Inside, and we literally didn't see any gameplay. We saw like this was the kind of trailer you expect when the game is still 2 years out.
They've shown videos of it in the past.
Yeah, I know, and I feel like in the past, we have seen more than what we saw this year, which was just really odd to me.
Yeah.
Nonetheless, made by the people who did Limbo, which shout out there, Limbo is free for this week. People should definitely be grabbing that if you don't have it, if you never tried it, because it is great, and I believe it works
code,
like
right?
Games for Gold, so you should be able to hold it forever
Limbo.
If you get it this week.
Nice.
And then but Inside comes out later this month. I'm excited for it. I'll buy it because I think it's probably gonna
be
a
good
game.
Some other games like Cuphead still, blah blah blah.
You know, they didn't really show
anything.
They still
show Cuphead? Did they show Cuphead?
No,
that
is
never
they
coming
didn't
out.
Really show
is that like that.
Yeah, I know.
This year or what?
Well, they've only got, what is it, like a 5-person team making the game? What is it? It's
I don't
a small
know.
Company making the game.
I actually did.
So I'm
reach
not
out.
Holding it against them.
I reached out to them a couple weeks back, maybe only a week ago, asking, like, what's going on? Why is there such a delay? Like, you guys haven't shown us anything. You looked like you were almost done. Apparently, after they initially announced Cuphead, they basically reset all their goals and stuff and made the game, like, 4 times bigger. So that's why it's taken so long.
Whoa. Does that mean... they're gonna charge us more for it?
No, probably not. We'll see.
If it's less than $20, I will be shocked.
I would expect it to be a $20 to $30
game. If it's less than $30, I'll probably be shocked.
with all the hype behind it, I think it should, might as well be a $30 game because they can get the money. Like, yeah. they're people are going to play.
Yeah, they could get away with
it. And
that.
It will still be worth it. It will. Right. Yeah, it's not like they'll be cheating us. Like, I think it will probably be worth $30. So,
yeah, it'll probably be better than 6 hours of gameplay.
Yeah. It's, you know, it's supposed to be a really hard game. So, it's going to be awesome.
Yeah, like Contra.
Yeah, exactly. Yes. And then, but so another indie game that they announced a little bit. They did show it off at last year, but no one really noticed it. I kind of noticed it just because I was it, like something stood out to me, and I had to like look it up and look into it more to like really understand what it was. But We Happy Few definitely made huge waves this year. Basically, it looks like BioShock meets Fallout. But more of an indie title, and a lot of people definitely are talking about it now. It caught a lot of
people off guard in a good way.
Yep,
caught a lot of us off guard in terms of how good it actually looks like.
Yeah, definitely.
I don't think any of us were really expecting much about it.
Yep, exactly.
And then we saw it's like, what is
off
this?
My radar completely.
Yep, yeah. No,
I mean,
Anubis
brought it up before. I mean, I think I remember Anubis showing us a little trailer for it. I don't know.
I definitely showed it to you.
I probably wrote it off
last year, Happy, especially you, because it's so twisted, and I know how twisted you are.
Yeah.
So that I was this is going to be Happy.
He
loves that stuff, and so that's why I was like, one of the reasons why it stood out to me so much.
I appreciate
like, oh, Happy's going to love
it. I really appreciate you. Anything twisted, just make sure you, appreciate it.
Happy, you get to eat a dead rat. You should be happy.
That was crazy. My first playthrough, I might actually choose to just be on my joy, and I'm going to take the happy pills. I'm curious as to what's going to happen.
I'm curious
because I feel like everyone's
going
to try to rebel and not take
change.
The happy pills. I want to see what
I'm
happens.
I'm curious
if I do.
How it's going to change before it becomes.
Yo,
the final
Anubis
product.
Is ready for the happy pills. I mean,
I'm ready
yo,
for those
this,
happy
this
pills.
Game is built for me. I mean, it's all about being happy.
Yep.
I'm already happy.
Yep.
I mean, I'm already. I'm
Don't
already
be a
there.
Downer.
Don't but
win.
Oh my
god.
But that's all. That looked really fun.
Horrible.
And then they announced they announced Tekken 7, which has been out in arcades for a long time, but you know it's finally coming to console, and a lot of fighting game fans are very excited for that.
It really took long
I
enough.
I was hoping I was going to be like Street Fighter X Tekken, but
nope. Yeah, no, we couldn't tell because they were showing
Akuma
the trend. First. But
King of Fighters is going to go in that route.
Oh yeah.
Yeah, the next one. What is it? 14.
So that was that. And then they came out with, and this was, let me make sure I say this. One of the biggest problems with Microsoft's conference as a whole was the stupid camera angles. They were the worst. And then
that was E3 in general.
Microsoft more than anyone else. More than anyone else.
Because they were Sony cameras, and Sony tampered with them.
That's what it was. it was sabotage. But for this next game, they decided to zoom out, and they staged zoom out for like the first 15 seconds because they wanted to show the snow.
Like, what is it?
They wanted to show the snow falling on the audience because it was a Christmas game. But then we finally found out that Dead Rising 4 had been announced. And that was, that's a pretty big announcement. It would have been really nice for us to see the trailer.
I was like, what are they cheering for, damn it?
Yeah, that was really annoying. Like, it was just so zoomed out. People start, like, going crazy. It's like, what the heck do we see? But yeah, so Dead Rising 4, I am very happy with the Christmas theme. I think that is going to be a really fun atmosphere.
Yeah,
and,
why not?
We're going to have some
you
cool,
can take
like,
selfies
candy
now
cane,
as Frank West. It is so awesome. Have you seen some of the selfies?
No.
Have you seen
you can,
the
like,
selfie theme?
Yeah.
Frank is like the best character ever. So I'm really...
I just started
following, like, they made a fake Twitter account for him, and it's hilarious.
Oh my god, I can imagine. That's definitely gonna be a fun Twitter.
If I liked Twitter, I'd probably follow.
But yeah, so that was a really cool big announcement. And then they showed off Scalebound, and what Forrest pointed out to me that I really thought was cool was the trailer for Scalebound this year was a direct continuation of last year's E3 trailer. And so that was really cool that they did that. Most people probably didn't catch that. I wouldn't have caught that.
What if it was just like half the trailer? Like they really already had
They could have, and it could have been. It could have been that. It could have been that they just cut last year's in half.
We don't have anything this year. Let's just continue this.
It could have been. Probably isn't.
Yeah, they might have.
But anyway,
it's like, oh, yeah,
it's
anyway,
not a bad idea.
It looks interesting. It's one of those games I'm on the fence with. I need to see more still. I definitely want to like it. I really want this game to be cool. A lot of comparisons to the Devil May Cry series.
Yeah, it even looks
Which
like the
all you
main
need
protagonist.
To know.
Yeah,
I
the
mean,
main protagonist
looks
definitely looks
very
like
similar.
Him.
Yeah, and, he's got a Dante air.
The selling point that's really cool and really makes me want to like it is the fact that you can just have co-op up to 4 players and you all have like customizable
your
dragons.
And characters.
Dragons.
Yeah, and so that's
you
really
you can ride your dragons.
That's really
in the
cool.
Air, together.
And
fight dungeons.
You know, I honestly it's don't love dragons penises. Nearly as much as other people, but it, you know,
yeah, I mean, yeah.
like if they were giant,
I've actually seen quite a few females
towards
the dragons.
If they were dogs, I would have loved them too. So it's not just dragons.
Yeah, I know
riding
more
a
women
dog, okay, yay.
Dire wolves.
Yeah, that's true. I see a lot more females.
Because they
wolves
breathe
I like.
Fire.
Wolves, because wolves are like.
Wolves are awesome.
Hardcore
and carnivorous.
Dogs.
They take what they want.
They're hardcore dogs, and so they're awesome. They're adorable but ferocious. Anyway, so
where
there was
with,
that was Scalebound.
With women and
oh, and then another game that again they showed off last year. It definitely got hype last year, but the hype has exploded now. Sea of Thieves. I'm very happy with the reception that this game is getting.
I think no one is more excited than Anubis for this.
I mean, I was
excited,
very
but, like, you
excited for it.
And by reception, I mean me.
I mean, for $15, you know.
$15?
What?
$15?
Oh,
wait. What do you mean $15?
Nope.
What are you thinking
of? Nope, I'm mixing that up.
$15. Yeah, this is
okay, now that everyone has
this
said that.
Is definitely a full-priced game.
This is not Tree Fitty.
Of $60. No, we're
yeah,
done
ahead.
With that. All right.
Darn.
No, this
you say it.
Sea of Thieves.
You say it for sure. You say $15.
The pirate game. Oh, okay, that's enough of that. The pirate game.
No, get it all out of your systems.
All right.
Tree Fitty.
The dollars.
Tree Fitty.
I know, but I can't even hear myself
sure,
think.
For sure. This is a disgraceful. You need to include yourself in the broadcast.
You really should just
otherwise,
include
sound
yourself.
Like we're talking
in,
to
yeah,
ourselves.
You should include
our
yourself
viewers
in the
will
broadcast.
Be confused.
Yeah, our viewers are going to get confused.
Well, I think they're going to get confused because Happy's just retarded.
They're going to just be confused by us
well,
in general, but...
Now that you state that,
they're
going to
be like...
Anubis, now
they're
going to
be
up.
Watching this, and they're going to be like, oh, look how sweet. They even have a mentally disabled person in their podcast.
I got to include all
I mean,
people.
Wow. I think that, so...
Yeah. But anyway, so Sea of Thieves, wow. A full retail-priced game. It's a pirate, basically. It's gonna have a system similar to Destiny, so it's not quite an
it
MMO.
It is an MMO, right?
It's or well, you know, it's an MMO, MMO like Destiny's an MMO. But
Destiny's
basically
like...
looks really cool. A lot of awesome ship
MMO.
Mechanics. We still don't know a lot. They said their next focus is to really get a beta going, because they want to just put it in our hands. So that's awesome, and I can't wait for that. But yeah, you know, pirate
so it,
MMO.
So did anyone get the vibe awesome. That it looks like there's going to be like mini raids or something like where you're trying to get to some of these caves to find lost treasure? Did that seem like that's what they were trying to show during the trailer?
I don't feel like that's what they were trying to
they
show.
They were showing
but
people going, yay, we found the treasure in the cave. Like, do you think there's going to be like a whole raid to get to that maybe? We're just speculating.
I thought they were just focusing on.
When did they have
each other in
people
boats?
Go yay in a cave?
Well, they were like it was like the CG thing. It wasn't like actual in-game.
The CG thing was a song.
Oh, really by the way, just to follow up, the
show what I'm
the game
about.
That I mixed it up with for $15 was actually Song of the Deep.
I thought that
similar
might be
title.
The one you were thinking of. Yeah, Song of the Deep,
yeah.
You know, I'll give that a shout. That actually
that,
did get
what,
shown at
thinking.
E3. It wasn't part of the conferences. That was a backstage thing.
Yeah,
I'll definitely give
that
a shout out,
that.
Though, because that's being published by GameStop. It looks good.
Right.
The reason I'm excited for it is because it's comparable to Ori and the Blind Forest. And I love Ori, so I'm excited for Song of the Deep. And
that's the one I was thinking for 15.
And yeah, so that one's 15. I'm getting the $30 collector's edition because I want all the goodies with it. And it's still $30 isn't much.
You're not gonna have any room for it.
No, there's no statue. It's just it's got a steel book. apparently, they're coming out with a children's book story, and that actually is gonna be sold like at Barnes and Noble, like it's a real thing. And that's part of the special edition, as well as some other things, and a voucher for the soundtrack. Yeah, shut up, Happy. No, you can't.
Absolutely.
Because you can only get it physically at GameStop. Everywhere else, it has
to
be digital.
Or Barnes & Noble.
No, that's where you get the book. That's not where you get the game.
Yeah, I know.
Anyway, so that's that game, but we'll move on from that. Sea of Thieves, again, can't stress that enough. That is my most hype, including Halo Wars 2. I am most hyped for Sea of Thieves. But yeah, we'll talk about
Halo
Wars 2.
Rare's always
done
justice.
I love Rare, and I love Pirates. But Halo Wars 2, really, really cool cinematic. I'm glad they brought back Cutter. I'm not quite sure where they're going with the story, because now we're shortly after the events of Halo 5. So I don't know what that means they're going to try to tie in. Are they going to, like, by bringing themselves so close to the current story mode, that restricts them a lot to what they can have, like, things have to make sense with the other game. So I feel like that's an odd choice.
I'm worried.
I'm a little bit worried about that. The beta is going on right now.
They can't bring back a bunch of Spartans because we know they're all dead. They can't do a lot of things.
But in the trailer, we saw Spartans. So I don't understand what they're doing.
Yeah, so I don't know where they're going to come from.
I think they're going to be...
That's because they got the... If you remember,
I think they're the Spartans that were from Halo Wars 1.
They got the Spartans off there. Yeah, they put them on
the
ship while that other guy, I forget his name, stayed behind to blow the bomb up. Yeah, Sergeant Forge stayed behind to blow the bomb up while he sent the Spartans back up.
I guess we're going to
have... They all went into cryo freeze.
I think they were just three Spartans, and so I guess we're just going to have those three Spartans. Again, I don't know. It seems fun. We played, Force and I have played the beta, and Vault played a little bit earlier today. It's nice. Force, you make a very good point that I'm a bit upset that the Covenant plays so much like the humans. That is,
there's literally no
they're really the same thing now,
just different
look and different units. Yeah. But
rock, paper, scissors.
Not even
very,
not
very
even
solid.
Look, because the buildings look very similar. Like, you remember in Halo Wars?
Yeah,
1,
the buildings do look.
They were like very human-esque, like blocky buildings.
A lot of people hated
Wars,
how overpowered like the armor was in Halo Wars.
Purple,
yeah, it looked very
shields.
Different.
They were very different. Now they're both like just buildings. I don't know. They're not.
There was
different.
A lot of overpowering in some cases with the Covenant, especially with the Arbiter. I mean, granted, he had to use a lot of shit.
Oh,
there was balances, yes,
one.
But there was a lot
really
of
really balanced game.
Yeah,
overall,
I mean,
it was,
obviously
just,
there were some issues.
Like, he pissed a lot of people off.
I think the rushes were a bigger problem, and rushes from humans were a bigger problem.
Warthog rushes,
Warthog rushes. Those were the biggest problem for Halo Wars 1, but we'll see what happens. Also, it's hard to kind of judge it right now, because they've got a weird control game type, and that's not what we want. We want like a deathmatch game mode, so we'll be able to judge it more when we try that. I guess that's supposed to come out like tomorrow or something. Is that game mode?
Totally 3v3 deathmatch.
Yeah, so we'll see if that happens, and we'll see if we like it more. But right now, Halo Wars 2 is... I mean, I'm definitely going to get it. It's a Halo game. It's fun, but it could definitely be better. So we'll see where they go with that. State of Decay 2.
I have a question for you.
Okay.
If the game... You know how most betas, when they fully come out, they're not very much different. I mean, let's be real. Most betas aren't
that much different. Yeah, no, they're not going to be very much different.
If the game is as it is now, let's say, okay, it does have deathmatch and all, but if this is all there is, these two races, we saw the units.
No, well, we know there's more than these two races. We already know that.
No, those are heroes. You're talking about heroes. Yeah, you can pick Covenant or Human, and there's three heroes on each side.
Oh, well, you keep saying races wrong.
What? I swear, everybody.
There's
you
human
should be saying sides.
Or Covenant.
You should be saying sides, not races.
First, Covenant isn't a side.
RTSs,
it's a faction.
They refer it as
or
race.
Isn't a race. It's a faction.
Well, I'm just saying that's what Anubis is
a
coming
A race
from.
Is a brute, which the brute that we play as isn't even Covenant.
The point is, I'm asking...
But you mean like alien or human?
The first one or the second one in its current state?
I'll need to play it some more. We also have no idea about the story. The story was very good in the first game. One of the best things about it was the beautiful cutscenes, which they did confirm Blur, which is the ones that did the cutscenes in the Halo Wars 1, is the same company doing it again. So we can expect the same awesome cutscenes. Halo Wars 1 was a very good game, so it might be better than Halo Wars 2. We'll find out. But
see how good. I'm not
I mean, I really
enjoyed
Halo
right
Wars
now.
1. I think Halo Wars 1 definitely had room for improvements, and so hopefully they'll take advantage of those without straying too far away. I feel like they're trying to play it more safe, though, with this one by the Covenant bot not being as unique as a playable team. And so maybe, I think that's what it is they're just trying to play it safe. So we'll see what happens.
There's been so many other RTSs where races play so differently, yet they were very balanced. So I don't see the excuse in having to make your only two playable factions so similar.
I think they're trying to make it simple for the stupid kids and
I mean, the
just
first one wasn't like that.
Have
so
a
why
wider
would they dumb
range.
It down?
The first one
no,
was the worst selling Halo game.
It's less time on them. Like honestly. There's
yeah, they're also
work
probably working on Halo 6 right
it.
Now as well. So if you think about
that
too.
I'm sure that's a different team. I would think.
Yeah, it's sure it's
well,
a different
they're
team.
All under the same company, right?
Yes, but it doesn't mean they're not different people.
Well, I'm just pointing out they may have pooled resources
like,
to work
yeah, they,
on it.
They may have. They may have. But I don't know. But, oh, you know, that's a good
that
point,
is,
though.
Could,
I was very shocked. No Halo 6. Because
we'll see it next year.
It's in the works.
Yeah, I know it's in the works, but they have for every Halo game,
they
have had two
E3s
before. For every major Halo game, they have had two E3s before the release. And if things stay on track, that means they won't do it this time. That's the first time that's ever happened. So that's big news for Halo people. Okay.
I mean, last year there was a lot of stuff they had to wait till Gamescom to show, and it's probably going to be the same thing this year. Which is probably also why we didn't see Crackdown 3, because they wanted to stay in that hour and a half slot.
Yeah, again, Crackdown
is
out on
E3. I mean, I think...
You know what I wouldn't
just
be surprised?
I don't know. Whatever.
What if Halo 6 requires... Or not requires, but is being optimized for Scorpio? So, like,
I
next
would
year's
expect
E3,
it to.
They'll announce it.
It's
and
gonna be optimized for 4K and virtual reality.
Well. Yeah,
it will be optimized for virtual reality.
It would make sense.
They're probably gonna make a.
They're
huge
not doing virtual reality.
Optimized for Scorpio.
Question is though.
They said they even said that the Scorpio will be VR ready.
Yeah, so
it's
this
got,
new Xbox.
Like yeah, but
S
it's not
Scorpio.
Their. It's not their VR. It's like supports Oculus Rift.
That doesn't
maybe,
mean they
perhaps,
can't make Halo 6 for VR
Hollands.
Though.
Now, Phil
just
said himself, they're not making first-party VR. They'll
yeah.
support other VR, but
they're
not developing their own.
You don't
think
they're going to
do
first-party VR
at
all? I don't think it's
going to
be
not this year, but the next,
game.
The
really
following year.
Right.
When, did we get a confirmation of when Scorpio is going to come out?
No.
Holiday 2017?
Fall next year. Yeah.
They said holiday 2017.
Yeah, but it's one of those things that I feel like it might get pushed, but... Who knows?
So, but that's different than the system, Xbox though, S, right? So that is the...
It's, yes, it's very different. Scorpio is the more powerful one that we're all excited for, because that one, supposedly, as of right now, Scorpio is the most powerful console ever made. So that's really cool.
I mean, that's the one, I guess we're not going to get Xbox S, but we're going to get the Scorpio.
Yeah, that's my plan.
Yeah,
and that's when I'm going to want a 4K TV.
I'm not even sure if I'm going to want a Scorpio.
Is more attractive to people who may not have one already.
Yeah. And that honestly, being said, I'm not even sure if I want a Scorpio, because it's mainly for 4K, and a lot of people don't want 4K still yet.
Well, I don't have a 4K TV yet, but now...
Yeah, a lot of people don't want 4K just yet.
Yep, a lot of people don't, but...
That's Vault,
you know,
because Vault just bought a TV and didn't get 4K.
And this year and the next year, there's going to be a huge increase in 4K. 4K is a growing thing, and it's getting to the point where...
Take it from somebody who's at Best Buy.
I'm still going to argue this. There's a lot of content out there that's still not even available in 1080. There's a lot of stuff that's still not even available in 1080 right now.
It doesn't matter.
So, I mean, I'm not in a huge rush for 4K, and I don't think a lot of other people are either.
I wasn't.
I'm not saying it won't be good.
Now, the thing is that I don't care about... Sure, 4K is not a big thing, but for me, it's high dynamic range, which is the HDR, which is exciting for me.
Well, that's with the S... as well.
Happy, yeah, you want to explain what that does? Because I don't know what that does.
So basically, you know how, I mean, it makes lighting and colors look a lot more realistic. Like, things can get a lot more brighter, and it's going to make things a lot more realistic
that
in
makes
video games and
Halo
in watching
3,
TVs.
Like, was an early, like, concept of that, Halo 3 was.
Okay, I understand.
Very early concept. Very early concept of that.
I mean, because it has a lot more brightness levels, it has a lot more gradations between colors and blacks. It just looks a lot more realistic.
You see real shadows.
That's cool.
When there's a shadow there, etc., etc.
That's really cool.
But I hope you guys know that they did say that the HDR component on the S has no effect on games, right? It's purely for video.
Yeah.
Yeah, well,
HDR gaming for something. They said HDR gaming on...
Yeah, I thought they said it was for the 4K.
Definitely
was,
saw there was
affect games.
I thought I saw something for HDR gaming.
The power.
It would. It was surprising that it wasn't. I thought they said that the first party titles, as in like things made by Microsoft, was going to support some HDR gaming, as in light can get more dynamic and there's going to have more colors available that can be accessed through the TV.
That could be a thing, but.
But it was only going to be first party.
They've already leaked
Microsoft
that
titles.
Gears of War is going to run better on the S than the One, very
it was,
slightly.
Yeah, it was
going to
have better, more colors. The
They've already leaked that.
Increase.
Well, I would hope there is some slight improvement on the S, so people have a little bit more of a reason to get it. But I still think waiting is the best option for people who don't have a lot of money and already have an Xbox One. As I tried to get into it earlier, but then we got sidetracked, but State of Decay 2, it was a well-received zombie game back when State of Decay 1 came out.
There are too many, though,
I didn't like it solely for the reason that it just was a single-player zombie game, and I didn't really want that. It had a lot of cool aspects to it, though. And so, with it having co-op, it's definitely something to keep your eyes open for. But yeah, I agree. I'm done with zombies unless it's another Left 4 Dead. Or honestly, Dead Rising, though. Because Dead Rising is a fun game. So,
That one game interests me.
Which one interests you?
It was on the Sony side.
Oh, yeah, I know what you're talking about.
Days Gone.
Yeah, we'll talk about that.
Days Gone. And then there's also Resident Evil.
But
you don't know. I don't really know if Resident Evil is going to have zombies.
So they ended it with Scorpio, and they said a lot of, like, hey, we're here, we're supporting the gamers, we're trying to give you the best gaming experience we can give you. We don't want to leave people behind.
We're sorry we fucked
yada,
up
yada,
the original
yada.
At the beginning of Xbox One. We're sorry.
I mean,
didn't really say that. But
yeah, well, they're never going to say that.
That apology was done last year. They're not.
Yeah, that apology was already done.
Well, this is basically it. They're saying, yeah, we know we're finally making what you guys wanted.
Oh, with the Scorpio, yeah, they were like, we read the feedback.
Yeah.
That, but that's consoles in general. That's not that's Xbox One, is it?
No, with the Scorpio, they're like, well, hey, we're going to start swinging.
Unlike,
it's not even we're going to listen. It's like, one, hey, we're going to be hitting hard punches now. Yeah. We're not.
Yo, and I'm excited because it has Oculus Rift compatibility.
It was basically acknowledging that they're losing the console race. And they're like, all right, we're going to stop losing now.
No, but it makes it so much more superior than the PS4, because the Oculus has one thing, it has better resolution, and that's important to me. If I'm having something strapped to my face, I'm gonna see those freaking pixels, you know, and if I have something really low resolution, I'm gonna notice that's lower quality.
Yeah.
So definitely it's a bonus to have the Oculus Rift rather than the Morpheus, which I read had a lower resolution.
Yes, yeah, so
it's a factor.
That's definitely something important. I just think overall VR is not gonna be a very big thing.
Recore.
Again,
$40,
kind of
beautiful game.
You know what?
Single player. I don't care. A single player.
Yeah.
I'm not.
Anubis, wait. Can I take Anubis on? Anubis. One thing is to think about VR as well. Is it how long of a cord is it to connect to the headset? Like, how much is that?
I have no idea.
Yeah.
But you know you're gonna get tangled.
For some people. Yeah, I mean, I'm just thinking about that, because if it's like a non-noticeable long cord, technically, you know, you could just kind of lie there. You don't really have to
get tangled
in
it. You might trip over it. I expect, similar to with the Wii, how people took some time before they stopped throwing their Wiimotes at the TV. It's going to take people some time to not trip and fall and rip cords out and hit people without seeing
them.
We've been
doing that for years with non-cordless controllers.
So, I rest my case. Like,
let me make sure I'm getting this right. Are you guys thinking there won't be is it just not capable? Or is... Like, technology-wise, is there not going to be a wireless VR set out there?
They're not going to want to throw the weight on there. You don't want that weight
on
your head.
Yeah.
It's going to be too heavy for your head to have...
The battery is going to be really heavy, probably.
It'll be like the Sega Game Gear all over again.
You don't... It will be too much for you to game for a long
game
period
of time.
Your little noggin's going to be heavy.
It's true, but that's beside the point.
Playing Sonic in color was so fun. Don't lie.
Yeah,
that
for the
fun.
5 minutes that the battery worked for.
But, Recore looks fun. I still want to know more about it, but at this point, I probably still will be getting it. Yeah, it looks really cool.
They were talking about it a little bit on IGN.
Like it's kind of
apparently
like a ratchet
you were sent from Earth to get it ready for colonization. Apparently something
went wrong. Yeah, so the story is basically you're getting...
They're not alluding to much more than that, but...
You were, like, frozen or something, and then these robots were supposed to kind of like Wall-E, you know, the robots are supposed to clean the Earth while you're away. But then you come back and the robots have kind of like malfunctioned.
Wall-E screwed everything up.
Yeah, Wall-E went evil. And so you basically have to fight these robots. Another thing about Recore that was cool is basically they explained there's three different cores. There's the blue, the yellow, and the red. The blue, one of them has
for
a
now,
name.
Anubis.
I want to say blue was Mac. I don't remember their names.
Yeah,
Mac. But the blue one is more of an energetic and excited robot personality. The yellow is a little bit more fearful and...
it just looks fun.
Scary cat.
It's more of a scary cat. And more cautious. And then the red is more of a brutish kind of personality.
This reminds me of... This reminds me of the cores from Portal 2. Or Portal in general.
Cores? What cores from Portal?
No, remember the Portal had
the personality
like
cores. Did you not play Portal?
Oh. I got
there
you.
Was personality cores that came off of GLaDOS.
Whenever GLaDOS.
Right, yeah, we all played Portal.
I forgot about that. I was thinking
the red
we were, like,
one was
trying
like
to talk about the turrets
rage
or something.
Mode.
Yeah, I know what you're talking about now.
Stop doing that. What are
yes.
you doing?
No,
are
that's very similar to that. And so you know, I can see myself connecting with these core orbs, and so I think it will be a fun game. I think it will have the emotion there. And then they've got, it sounds like they've got some cool upgrading mechanics in it. So I think it's, yeah, I think it's going to be a fun game.
It's really fun. I don't care that there's no multiplayer. I'm perfectly fine with that.
No, I don't even want this to be a multiplayer
game.
I'm fine with that.
I'm perfectly fine with that. Some people, I guess, were, and that may be why they decided to make it for $40, because there won't be any multiplayer of any kind. But some games don't need it, and this doesn't really need it. I mean, I could understand co-op, but
I can understand why it's $40 really, though, because I mean, looking at the actual gameplay, it does, I mean, it is kind of different. It's very, I mean, it's very third person, but it's out there third person. It's not as closed in.
It reminds me of, like, in a weird way, it just a more shoot 'em up version of Too Human.
Everything's Too Human with you.
He really is comparing it to so many games. If there's shooting robots in it, he says it's Too Human.
Exactly. That's the only game he knows with robots.
That is a hell of a mix.
No.
But yeah,
and just like the, you know, the arcade style, kind of like shoot 'em and then numbers flying out. It is a very different game, and I can kind of see why, if you were to place a $60 game tag and it doesn't have any multiplayer, it probably wouldn't do so great in sales. So I think it's smart actually for them to place it $40, just because the game is so different,
and because not very many people know about it as well.
Yeah, saying. The fact it is good publicity to say, hey, this game's actually not starting off at $60. Like, that is a good, because there's not games pretty much don't do that. So it is a good way to get the word out about the game. So I do think it is kind of it is good marketing as well.
I will also say it's definitely, I think the graphics could be improved though.
Yeah, the graphics,
I think
are
the graphics are a bit low, and so that might also be part of that price point.
Yeah, that's because that is also low one that I think that deserves that.
Yeah,
price point.
The cutscenes are phenomenal. But the gameplay,
you can't tell on your TV vault.
Oh, shut up, Happy.
The gameplay, the graphics looked
awesome. It's not running
in 4K,
nice,
Happy, but
therefore it looks shit to
they
you.
They didn't look awesome.
No, it's upscale.
Especially there was one part where there was like this fire explosion, and it looked like some old fire graphics. And so they probably, I would have rather paid $60 and had a more polished looking game, but whatever. Maybe they'll still polish it.
Yeah, that was definitely why I was thinking $40 whenever I saw that it was basically the lower quality graphics. And just the, which, I mean, maybe they thought they could get away with because it is kind of further away. You know, you're not really zoomed into the enemy, so you really, I mean, obviously, it's not going to show that kind of detail, but I really do think even if you're that zoomed away, you definitely could have made a more graphically, graphic capturing, like, quality game.
Yeah. That's all I've got on the Microsoft conference. Anyone have anything else before I go to Ubisoft? No. Right. We're going to Ubisoft.
Yeah, go to Ubisoft.
So they open it up with Just Dance, fun little dance routine. And you know, you always expect a Just Dance thing, so you know, I'm fine with them just kind of opening it and then just being done and then moving on, and so that was nice.
As long as that's it.
Yeah. And you know, Ubisoft has Aisha Tyler, and she
dances
my second favorite presenter for these E3s, and she's just a blast. And so she's worth me noting as part of their conference. It's just Aisha Tyler is part of that. They went into Ghost Recon Wildlands. They showed us a lot, which was great, because up until now we didn't really know much about it, and so they really showed off a lot. It felt very Rainbow Six Siege to me. It is a Tom Clancy game, and so that's probably why. But they also presented it like a team that was being very tactical, and so that's why it felt like a Siege game.
God, remember that Siege demo? That was like,
you know, it was
so scripted. And yeah, it was so different.
And that was the problem with this one too. It was very scripted. But I will say, after playing Siege, and although it was scripted, that is kind of how you play the game. You are very tactical.
It is,
and you
kind
communicate
of
like that.
Like,
I don't know if
I feel like you're not
Wildlands.
I like going down. Like, it made it seem like almost in the simulation, like it was like you could really bust through anywhere. Like the whole house was like completely,
you pretty much
up for grabs.
There's a lot of places you can bust through. You can't break a whole house, because then you just destroy the whole house, and that just ruins gameplay.
Yeah.
In my mind. For that kind of game,
I agree.
At least. But, so Ghost Recon Wildlands looks really cool. Beautiful graphics. Looks like a lot of fun for anyone who likes the Ghost Recon games. But then they got into probably my favorite presentation, South Park, The Fractured But Whole. And it was...
I love the opening for
that. It was their best... It was Trey and Matt and Trey's best E3. Their third one, and each one has been really funny, but this one had me laughing hard. It was they're funny. Like the fact that they called out Kanye in his game, his like take his mother to heaven game, was really funny to me. But South Park looks like a great evolution of the last one. The Stick of Truth was a phenomenal South Park game. It up until Stick of Truth, their little arcade games were pretty lackluster, and so I did not get Stick of Truth right off the bat because I was just like, I'm not going to spend $60. I don't think these guys are going to do that good of a job. Totally worth a $60 price point for Stick of Truth, and so I I already pre-ordered the collector's edition for this one because my faith has been restored.
Ooh, come with the statue.
Yeah, it comes with the Cartman as the coon. Just it's exactly like the other one where the statue
Aww.
Was Cartman dressed
no,
as
no Mr. Hanky the Christmas poo. Aww.
No, you don't. I mean, go. I'll go use the toilet
no collectible,
and I'll,
Mr.
I'll send you a collectible.
I feel like those two are just awesome at everything they do.
They really are.
Yeah,
they're,
they really are.
They're
like,
so much
just...
fun. And so...
Like, I don't know what else just, like... they've done, but like Book of Mormon is amazing.
Yeah.
And
yeah.
then
yeah.
South Park,
yeah,
I
really
recently got into that. And I want to play their video games.
You definitely should. They did announce that with the... when you get the second one, you do... They remastered the first, well, not really remastered, they just ported it over. Like, it's South Park. How do you remaster those graphics? You don't, because they're South Park.
I wish you could see that. We remastered the graphics.
Is it available for the one?
It's so that's what I'm trying to get at. Yeah, so they have
rebuilt
the,
it from the ground up.
Version for the PS4 and the one Stick of Truth, and you get it for free if you get the second one. And for sure, since you always get things digitally, the way that should work, because you get it digitally, is you should be able to pre-purchase the second one, and then you'll get the first one, and you'll be able to play. You should be able to play that like today, like once you pre-order it.
I
will definitely
buy the remaster.
Fractured Butthole.
The Fractured Butthole.
okay.
But I'll say it now.
It's so good. It's just fractured it's too butthole. Best. Like, and I love that they came out. And I want to say, I think it was Trey. He was just like, yeah, you know, Marvel originally wanted to call it Captain America, The Fractured But Whole, but since we had the rights already, they just called it the Civil War.
That's great.
They're too funny. They're too funny.
Oh, my God.
But I definitely will vouch for that for sure. I absolutely loved the Stick of Truth, and so I have very high hopes for this.
It is turn-based, though. Well, it is turn-based, and you would have to play turn-based games.
It is like a JRPG, so yeah. If you want, like, look up some YouTube gameplay, just make sure it's something you want,
yeah,
that you think you would enjoy.
Hilarious, but you also want to make sure it's a game that you wouldn't mind playing.
Yeah, make sure the gameplay is something you could do.
I'm big on JRPGs, so I'm okay with it, but it might not be everybody's cup of tea.
Yeah, I am not, a fan of JRPGs
gameplay
very much.
Sometimes.
But
it's fun, though.
For me, it's mostly because of anime I don't like. So like I liked Costume Quest 2. We just got that for free like a month ago, and that was a fun game actually. So
yeah, those were nice.
So yeah, and
I love the first demo at the first game, so I'm definitely gonna enjoy Costume Quest 2.
Yeah, you definitely will.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, they're both great.
But yeah, so South Park had a phenomenal presentation. Some of the new things for this one is now it's kind of got a grid layout so you can actually move in battle. And you can use other characters or the scenery around to maybe do some extra damage. They've got I don't know how I want to say this, like a re-roll ability where like you can fart and then it will rearrange the order of people playing, and basically, I guess, give you more turns. I still have to wrap my head around that concept. It's not like something I've ever encountered before. I do not do many JRPGs. But so that was really cool, and you know,
I don't know if I could call it a JRPG.
Some Final Fantasy, he'll be okay.
I don't know. I don't know if it is a JRPG. I'm just saying I don't know if it's a JRPG thing because I don't do a lot of JRPGs.
What's wrong with you?
But you know, basically, the main difference is now it's superhero based. And if you haven't seen the trailer, watch the trailer because it's just rips apart the Marvel Cinematic Universe and what they're doing and all these superhero movies, and it is so funny, just so funny. But moving on from South Park, because I could talk about that all day. The Division, they talked about some future DLC. I don't really like Division, so you know, cool for everyone who likes Division.
Go, guys. Have a good night. Fun.
All right, have a good night, Vault.
Okay.
For everyone who has Division and likes Division, the DLC that's coming out looks fun. I'll say the cool part that really intrigued me is one of the DLCs they showed had this like guy who clearly had some of the Division watches on him. So he basically gave the appearance of he's hunting down Division agents and killing them. So equate that to like a Sith master who's hunting down Jedi, basically, is how I'm imagining that. So that he could
he's
be really cool.
The younglings.
Yeah, well,
he's killing killing the younglings.
Yeah, basically. So that looks like it'd be a cool fight. Then they showed off some Star Trek VR, you know, just showing off some of their VR stuff. Star Trek VR.
No, Star Trek.
You're
gonna play. You're basically commanding the Enterprise.
Oh yeah.
And honestly, it didn't look like a fun game to me. It's definitely for the people who are really hardcore Trekkies. That's definitely for them. The cool thing they had, though, is they had like four different Star Trek characters from different Star Trek shows presenting it and talking about it, and that was cool. So that was definitely good, like, marketing on it. But yeah, you know, Star Trek VR, command the Enterprise, and have fun, work as a team. But then they went into For Honor, a game that I was very excited for from last E3. And so now we know that it has a single player, which was very reminiscent to me of Rise, Son of Rome, which I thought was a good game. It was just a bit short, but it was a very good game. And so...
when you were glitching.
You had a glitch where you couldn't get past a tree. But I didn't have that glitch.
I had multiple glitches.
Well, I didn't have any glitches. You had glitches because you always break games. I didn't have glitches.
That's true.
So it was a very fun game, and I'm very excited for Honor. You know, basically it's Vikings versus Samurais versus Knights, and it looks like a lot of fun. I did not expect it to have a single player at all, so that's pretty cool. They also talked about one of their games called Grow Up. It's Grow Up. It's basically they had a game come out a while back called Grow Home or something, and so it's like a sequel to that, but I could have sworn I heard them say it was a new IP, which doesn't make sense to me because I am 100% it's not new, but I don't know. But that was that. But then they had, in my opinion, my least favorite presentation, just because I couldn't stand the people. It was for Trials Blood Dragon DLC. This is DLC for the game Trials, and it's basically like the DLC for Far Cry was with Blood Dragon, where it's campy 90s silliness. But these guys that came out were just like trying way too hard to be cool, and they had the most ugly, I call it costumes, it was clothing, but you know that joke about a zebra in a blender? Well, they wore that zebra in a blender on stage. And and that's no joke. It was literally, it was zebra pattern with blood looking stains all over. It was the ugliest things I had ever seen people wear. And that was just really distracting and painful for me to look at. So yeah, that was Trials. But I mean, if you're a fan of Trials, though, campy 90s fun is definitely in store. Like, it, the game itself looked like, you know, if you like Trials, this is going to be a great add-on for you. And then they talked about the Assassin's Creed movie. And I had made the prediction they were going to talk about this movie in addition to what their plans are for the next game. They did not mention their next game at all. They just talked about the stupid movie. And
annoying.
And so that was dumb. That was plain and simple. It was a plug for their movie, and that was it. But then
you're making me glad I didn't watch the Ubisoft conference.
You should watch it. If nothing else, I posted in the video game page about the South Park presentation. I posted the Matt and Trey talking, and then also the actual trailer. Watch those. That is
okay.
So
I saw
good.
The trailer, I'm pre-ordering it right
now. No, watch Matt and Trey talk about it. Okay. Because
that just made an that impulse had me purchase.
There you go, for sure. That's the way to do it.
it's in her name.
But
Craig.
Yep. But then they talked about Watch Dogs 2. And Force, are you still here? Because
yep.
All right, you're excited for this. I'm not really excited for this. So why don't you talk about Watch Dogs 2?
Watch Dogs 2. Well, I don't know how to explain it. It seems like everybody hates this game except for me.
What are you excited for?
It's not bad. People just jumped on the hate bandwagon really fast.
They definitely did jump on the bandwagon.
It looks really different from the first one, but I guess there's some similarities. They only show like one mission where you're infiltrating like a party in a hotel high rise in San Diego.
I like how they're still making it. They're like, oh, I don't care if you guys hate it. We're making another one, so screw you.
I feel like it didn't do bad, though, did it? I feel like it sold well.
No, it sold really well. It's just people complain because it didn't look like the E3 demo.
It definitely has like a... I always say it has like a Grand Theft Auto meets Assassin's Creed type deal. Like if you mix the two.
Yeah,
it's not like killing people
with hacking.
But you are sneaking into places. You're trying to get to like one certain objective done. And in Assassin's Creed, I was killing someone. In Watch Dogs, it was maybe like hacking something or...
You're continuously eavesdropping, following somebody, and then them mysteriously looking behind them every, you know...
Well, there was no mission like that, but... There were some times where you had to like tap a phone line or tap a surveillance system, whatever.
Or
but
tap a girl.
But this presentation,
you know?
Oh yeah, the Grand Theft Auto part. But yeah, in the first game, like yeah, there was an open world. You could steal cars and lots of guns and adventures and stuff like that. But they just show like one mission where you know he's in a building or a hotel and throwing little gadgets around, and of course it culminates in a firefight. But I'm pretty excited. Because I liked Watch Dogs.
All right.
So the big fuss was about it being bad.
Yeah, I don't know. They're definitely hyping it. I just... I'm not even saying... I don't know. It just doesn't look that interesting to me. I feel like their marketing for it hasn't been very clear on like what is really going on. I don't know. So that's, I feel like they need some better marketing for it to help explain it to people and get people back
into Watch Dogs. I think they're marketing it too much. Like, you can't go anywhere online without seeing that stupid...
Well, no. I mean, yeah, they're definitely overplaying that stupid commercial, but I'm saying, like, they need to not just play it less. They need to have a more... They need to have a better commercial that explains it better than what that is.
I think... When you attach a 2 or something, they're probably targeting the audience that played the 1 of said 2, whatever it is. You know, just in general, they always do that.
In general, but since
general, I think
Halo
2
was
like
they didn't explain what Halo was because they assumed
if they think it's done
Halo
with it,
was.
They don't think they're gonna sell any more Watch Dogs. They should just include the first one and just kind of like kind of bundle it like everyone else seems to be doing with video games, and then
I wouldn't be surprised kind of
just
if
just throw
they
them
do.
Into that universe.
Wouldn't be surprised.
Yeah,
if
but
they
I mean,
do.
Like then they just be like they kind of do what they did the first one, act like you know you can hack everything, you know, just kind of like show them, maybe like even like a actual kind of a live action trailer would be fine. I don't know. That sometimes does well.
No, live action trailers definitely do well.
Also,
and something like
I don't
that
know
wouldn't be
if
too
any
expensive.
Other games have done this, but I just remembered Watch Dogs 1 is probably the only game I know that had multiplayer, multi-platform gameplay in like this, like some person could be playing on a tablet and another person was playing like the game, but it was like two different experiences. Like the person
remember
playing
Dead Rising
game,
3 had that.
Did it? I don't remember.
Yep.
Well, I mean. What you
smart
could,
glass.
I didn't use it, but I don't remember.
Division
well,
was supposed
was like
to
a,
have it, but I think they
thing,
took
right?
it out. It was,
That was you working together, right?
Well, I mean, that's what Dead Rising
I
is working
right?
together.
Yeah, but in Watch Dogs, it was, you were against this person. Like, the person on the
yeah,
tablet
I remember
was
that.
Trying to, like, beat you, and you were trying to beat them. So on the full game, you were, like, driving through the town, trying to get from point A to point B. And on the tablet, they were trying to stop you by, like, activating traps and whatnot and sending things
your way. Oh, that's kind of cool.
But I thought that was really cool. Yeah, that I played that a lot.
I remember seeing that,
yeah. But, yeah, so, I mean, watch it. I'm not writing it off as a good game. It's just, it's definitely going to be a game I don't get because I just, I don't need to try to get myself involved in that universe because there's too many other games for me to play.
Oh, yeah.
So,
I'm totally not into it, so, yeah.
What a wonderful world we live in, where we have so many games to play.
It is.
What a wonderful country we live in, where we have freedom of choice. You must buy this game!
Yep, it's great living in Canada.
It's not Kim Jong-un, the video game. Kim Jong-un. No, I'm just joking. You don't play as Kim Jong-un. Only Kim Jong-un can play as Kim Jong-un.
Happy, are you talking?
Yeah, okay, yeah, so we're gonna move on. We're gonna say they Ubisoft came
shut
out
him
and
up.
They announced a new IP. No one really saw this coming at all.
I'm hyped for this. This
you're,
is something
okay,
I'm
okay. I was
for,
like probably. Falling asleep, but honestly, it was probably due. Well, I don't have interest in this genre, but also it was probably due to the fact that I was just tired from like watching E3 all and like my adrenaline's been going because Microsoft conference already happened and stuff. So, like. Oh, I got kicked out from that party.
There he is.
Davis, how hyped are you? You're
so
hyped.
Yeah.
Sorry.
He was
so hyped.
I just
want
to leave
party
game.
I was so excited from E3 and stuff. You know, and just getting disconnected here. Everyone, make sure you have your audio included again.
Audio is included, for sure.
Make don't you tell me what to do,
but,
you're not my mom.
But yeah, so they announced a new IP, Steep, and it's basically like SSX. It's you know if you want
it's
like
tricky.
A snowboarding
well, the
extreme.
Is so much better.
I loved extreme. SSX Tricky so much. Oh my god,
me
Eddie
too.
Was my character of choice.
So it's basically like the only game in that genre, honestly. There are no other games that
it's
are like that
sports.
Anymore for action sports.
It's kind of like that rare off game, like that farming game. Like what genre
simulator?
Is that?
Farming simulator?
Farmville?
Yeah, no, not Farmville.
It's just like a rare one-off that
we won't talk about
appeals
Farmville.
To a crowd.
Yep,
but Steep,
no,
simulator
premise
getting Farming Simulator
is really interesting.
I think Steep is going to appeal to a lot more people than Farming Simulator does, but that could be just me.
I would hope.
I don't know. I mean, if, you know, if you like Farming Simulator, you like Farming Simulator. It's just.
I mean, have
really
you even played
game.
It in Anubis? Can
I've
you
never,
really?
I can't
down?
Say for 100% that it's a horrible
you
game,
may
but
think
it really
better
does
than
not
Halo.
Interest me.
Oh
yeah,
my god.
I can't imagine that being the case, but I can't say for
well,
certainty.
If you haven't played it.
Yeah, I,
then,
no, I can't say
I'm
for
just,
certainty.
I'm just picturing Brian saying this, and I can't. My head
yeah.
can't even go there.
but yeah, so
Steve, sorry, Master Chief, but I played a lot of this.
Extreme sports, if you want to do that. That's
I found
that
another.
And then we got PlayStation's conference. Did anyone have anything
finally.
On Ubisoft before we get to PlayStation? Yeah, we're almost done.
Steep's was amazing.
All right.
Do we have to talk about PlayStation?
You know what? For sure, I definitely like your enthusiasm of not talking about PlayStation. But no, we definitely should talk about PlayStation. They actually, in my opinion, them and Bethesda had the best conferences. I wasn't a huge fan of Microsoft's conference this year. They definitely had better camera angles than Microsoft did. That's true. Microsoft did, and maybe that's part of the hype is the fact that Microsoft didn't announce anything, any new console for this year. So they had less focus on games. That interested me. I'm saying
that's the big thing right there. Yeah.
So basically, this is the way I look at it. Is last year, and people call me a fanboy for this, and it drives me insane because I can't apparently have an opinion without just being a fanboy. I think Xbox won last year's E3 because they were games. They were throwing punches left and right. But everyone's like, no, PlayStation won because all these games that still haven't even come out yet. But
last year they had the bomb just saw backwards compatibility.
That was it.
I
think Microsoft won last year. That killed everything.
But basically, this year PlayStation was all games. They were very little talk, and what they have been doing the past couple years that I has been always a snooze for me, which they didn't do this year, which was very good for them. They didn't have like 15 minutes dedicated to a montage of indie games that no one cares about. And well,
I like a lot of indie games,
but they didn't. A lot of the PlayStation, like they're smaller. Like for example, last year, no joke, PlayStation fans were hyped about Zombie Taxi and Job Simulator. So those were things from Sony's E3 last year, and people want to tell me that they won. But this year, PlayStation was all about games. And so that's why really appealed to me. What happened is the Happy having issues. Yeah.
Bye, Happy.
Okay. He'll get back in here soon. I guess for some reason he couldn't hear me. Hear him. I don't know if
Everybody just we can hear all that. So that was just awkward for us.
Okay. But
cut out.
So anyway, on to PlayStation. They did a good job. They started it off with an orchestra. That was fancy and classy. Pretty nice.
Very nice.
Fancy and classy.
It was.
Even though when they did it, it was just like, why are they doing this?
I was a little bit, it was nice, but at first I was like, why are they doing this? And then I definitely questioned it when the one woman kind of started going a little crazy. And he was just like, woo, woo, woo.
Oh, yeah.
And I was just like, what? So
that was pretty funny. Like, you could not laugh at that.
Yeah, no, that
I can't believe that no one else in the audience laughed at it just because, like, I'm not, or, like, I was
they probably
expecting
did,
to hear something.
You couldn't hear them.
Yeah, they probably giggled. But, but the orchestra was nice. And they used that orchestra throughout the presentation. And so that was
awesome.
That was cool. It wasn't needed, but it was a nice little touch.
They were real classy.
The presenter, I don't know his name. The
angry eyebrows.
The angry eyebrow, yeah, because he looks mad. It's just his eyebrows.
Yeah, but the one who has like no neck.
Him. He did a good job presenting this year. I usually don't like him, but he was very concise and to the point this year. He didn't rabble on. He had one jab at Xbox, which again wasn't needed. PlayStation people are low like that, and they always got to throw punches and not be professional.
I think they're told they have to do that before it starts.
They probably are. Because
like, get at least one in there.
You gotta get a jab in there.
And
it wasn't even a good jab too. It was a jab about something he's clearly jealous about. He's trying to make fun of Phil Spencer for having
t-shirts.
His t-shirt because that was one of the cleverest things I've seen a presenter do, is tease future games with what he's wearing. That's brilliant. And so to try to make fun of that is dumb. But other than that, he was a great presenter. So and like I said, they their camera angles were much better than Xbox's, which were all over the place. They opened up with God of War, which is not God of War 4, so I guess it's a reimagining of God of War. It looked a lot more like a Last
Bearded
of Us
Kratos.
Kind of thing. Yeah, Kratos with a beard. It looked awesome. Graphics were beautiful.
Is anyone else Greek, surprised they didn't make a Last of Us 2 yet? I thought they were going to make one. I really thought
there
they were
was definitely a rumor for Last of Us 2.
There's a spiritual successor to it, that's why. Which is that one game I was talking about.
Oh, the Days Gone, you mean?
Yeah.
No, but that's not... Is that by Naughty Dog as well?
No, I don't think so.
No,
I think it's a different
studio.
That's
like the feeling of it.
It's definitely not going to be as big as Last of Us.
No,
but
that sold really well, so I'm really surprised that they're not making a second one yet.
I Maybe think they're making a second one.
I think
it will. I think
so too.
I think it'll
because that was
come
such
out
a big
with
success.
The Neo, maybe.
Oh wait, well, one thing is I never played it, so I don't know if it actually ended on a note where they could have a sequel. But I'm assuming
yeah,
they did.
You could make a sequel or prequel, depending. You could do something.
Yeah, sequel or prequel or some type of continuation of the story.
Yeah.
You know, as long as they haven't, you know, completely.
You could honestly just have all new characters called Last of Us 2. It's like, it's
yeah,
able
exactly.
to do
like,
that.
There's so many ways they can just feed off the franchise.
Right.
But yeah, God of War looked really, really good. That was definitely their best looking game. Days Gone, which Force is very excited for. It looked all right. I will say, very good job with the movement of the zombies. That looked really good.
Yeah, that and the hordes of them coming on.
And the amount
that,
of them. Yeah, it's
nice.
Similar to like Dead Rising.
Yeah, definitely that was impressive.
So,
I did
they've
see
got
one
so
moment.
Many zombies on screen.
I did see one moment where one of them actually jumped out of the window and he was on fire because earlier he like lit something on fire and the zombies were on fire. So it was awesome to see like a burning zombie jump through a window at you.
Yeah.
It's the little things.
Yeah, yeah.
Like,
so
like
it looks interesting, but it doesn't look phenomenal. They showed off Last Guardian. They are staying strong with
which
the release
is actually
date for
coming
this
out this
year.
Time.
So
it's really happening.
It seems like it really is happening. And so that's interesting. Again, though, I don't think Last Guardian is going to be a niche audience kind of thing. It's definitely not going to grab everybody. But you know, at least it's
like,
coming out.
Yeah.
Yeah, at least it's coming out. Horizon Zero Dawn, I guess is what that one's called.
Yeah,
which
that
is
looks
apparently Two Human Two.
Yeah, yeah.
Oh, here
yeah,
we go again.
Vault also compared that to Two Human. Like he really, if there's a robot, I guess that's what his brain jumps to is Two Human. But Horizon looks very good to me as well. The God of War and Horizon are the two games that I would want on the Xbox.
Well, there's also another game, but
actually, there is one other game that I'll get to later that I'm jealous is an exclusive to PlayStation, and I'm sure it's not the one Happy's thinking of because Happy doesn't even know about it. I'm sure, but
probably not. We'll see.
So yeah, Horizon looks really cool. Basically, like Vikings fighting robot animal things, and we got to figure out, you know, how this happened and stuff, I guess. Detroit looked really good. That's basically a new like Heavy Rain kind of game where you're like,
oh, that game looks amazing.
It looks amazing. I don't know how it would
visually,
be a game though. I'm not
that's the one
that
I'm talking about,
Anubis.
That's the one I'm talking about.
Yeah, so there is a different game.
I need to see
more about
fun...
that before I say I want that on the one.
Yeah.
It looks cool,
but we haven't seen much yet.
Yeah, we haven't seen enough for me to be convinced. But it definitely looked cool. You know, having decisions is really cool. But we'll see where that goes.
Anyone who played Heavy Rain, though, that is a phenomenal game, I must say. Like, I played through it, and my stepbrother played through it, and it was just so funny. Like, I got such a great ending, and he got such a freaking heart-wrenching ending. Like, his was, like, so sad. Mine was so happy. Like, they're a family at the end. Him, like the protagonist gets shot, dying in the other, like, your loved one's arm. It's just like, wow, that was completely different. So...
Yeah,
it's really fun.
great
games where you do have choices is really cool. And it's not just like choices like you know in Dishonored where you have choices. It's like there are like 30 different endings or something.
Yeah, it's
where
not
you
like
can
Telltale
choose,
choices.
It's ridiculous. Yeah, it's not like Telltale. This is like, you know, you can like it has to go through this set in order, and then you get this ending. Where really it's crazy how many times you have to play to get every ending.
But
I agree. I really loved it.
Looks cool. Then they announced Resident Evil 7, which I'm about to hand it over to Justin. But real quick, I'm gonna point out they have now gone a bit away from their normal look of a Resident Evil game, and they're going more into a first-person horror suspense kind of style, which I'm a bit worried that they're trying to make it work with VR too much, and I'm not sure how this will work out. But Justin, why don't you tell us, because you played the PlayStation exclusive demo for it, so go ahead and tell us what you thought about it.
All right. Well, first, have any of you guys ever played the PT Silent Hills demo before?
I want to. I wish I did. I don't own a PlayStation, but from what I've heard, it's amazing, and I'm a really big Silent Hill fan, so that is probably one of the biggest regrets of my life. I haven't played it.
It was so good. It was probably one of the scariest gaming experiences I think I've ever had, like, even up there with Amnesia and, like, Alien vs. Predator 2, like, really, really scary stuff. This one, they were definitely going for that kind of feel. Again, no
That's
doubt.
That's what I imagined.
Again, they were going, because they were going with the first-person view.
Yeah, and I think that PT was so successful, and I think that's why I think it's gonna like a whole new genre of just first person horror from that success that never came.
Yeah, and I don't blame them if it does. I mean, PT was absolutely terrifying, so I'm okay with them going in this direction if that's the case. But this demo, so it's very short. You can actually beat it in about 15 to 20 minutes or so, depending on how much you explore. But the thing is, it's got different endings depending on what you do. So the first time you play it, you're gonna follow some clues, and you eventually find, you're in this house, and you just wake up. This TV is plugged in, but there's nothing in it. You eventually find a videotape while exploring this creaky, old, weird house, and you watch it, and you actually play as the cameraman in this VHS tape video that you're watching, and so you see some weird crazy shit go on there, and you some things you do during that video can actually impact the present situation that you're in. Like there's one scene where you can find a lockpick in the house during that past sequence and actually unlock something that helps you get a weapon later on, which again changes one of the endings. As far as you know, though, while you're exploring, there is a weird ghost lady flying around, again, just like the one in the PT demo, and all of the guys you were with, there were like three guys who were trying to film this house because they thought it was haunted or something. They all get murdered pretty bad, and you come out of it learning about the secret passage in a fireplace, and then so you go through that, you get a key to get to the back door, and then you start to see this hillbilly guy walking around like Texas Chainsaw Massacre kind of style. And it seems like no matter what you do to try to get out of this house, at least so far, you can't get out. This guy catches you, knocks you out, says something like, "Welcome to the family, son." And it's as if there's just no escape. There's all these different ways to go about the level. There's different items you can find depending on the order you do things. I've gotten at least like four or five different endings so far, but they all still end with that guy catching you and beating you. But it's the developers have kind of hinted that nobody figured everything out yet. There was this one item called a dummy finger. It was literally like a finger from like a mannequin or a dummy or something. It's the only item that nobody, like on the whole internet, you'll see pages and pages of message boards about this finger. Nobody knows what it does.
I saw something says like, "Does this have a purpose?"
Right. No one knows. So some people think it's just Capcom literally giving us the finger. Haha. But nobody really knows the purpose behind it. But it's really intriguing, and people are still finding more and more things, just like they did in the PT demo. There's so many things going on in this, despite how short of a demo that it is, and it's just been really interesting, and I hope we continue to find out more soon. If people don't figure it out, maybe the developers will tell us. I mean, if they could figure out PT, where you have to actually speak into a microphone just to get the true ending, I would figure out Resident Evil, too. But I will say I like this direction. It's obviously nothing like any of the past Resident Evils, and it's not going to feel like a Resident Evil game. There's like one small reference to the Umbrella Corp when you find a picture of a helicopter with their logo on it. And there's a rumor that this person you talk to on the phone in one sequence might have been one of the main characters, like I think Ada. Was that her name, Ada? I forget now.
I think so. That sounds familiar.
Yeah, I think it was Ada Wong. Some people think that might have been her, but nobody knows for sure. But other than that, it doesn't feel Resident Evil-like at all, really. Nobody knows what the connection even is at this point. And I'm not sure if the developers intend for the game to really play like this either. But it's up in the air. The only weapon you can get is an axe.
I did hear that.
You don't really get to use it.
The game will not be like the demo.
Yeah, that is what I got from that, is that this is more just something to show off some hints about what's to come in the story more than anything else. But it was really, really intriguing, I will say. I was up like all night last night just reading conspiracy theories about things. Like, one person tried analyzing this lamp where the light was blinking funny, and they tried to translate it into Morse code to see if it spelled out anything. Like, people are going nuts to figure all this out.
Yeah.
That's so kind of like, you know, in Silent Hill, there was some older Silent Hill games. There are some pretty far out puzzles you have to figure out, which is kind of the fun between it. It's like, you know, you're in this place and you really gotta, you know, put your maximize your knowledge of everything just to figure out a puzzle, and it's kind of fun. It's the way I wish that, you know, almost like, it's you know how they have those, have you ever heard of those places where you get locked in a room and you gotta figure out the puzzles? There's actual places like that. I know they're pretty popular here in Texas, but I just wish they were more like the actual video games.
Nice. Yeah, I would be interested in that, actually. That's cool. But that's pretty much my take and input on the demo so far. Is just really, really, really interesting, if a bit confusing at the time.
But I mean, that's kind of what it is.
Very, very nice.
And then, you know, with toting how that is, the full game is going to be in VR. They also went on some other VR stuff, which did not really interest me. They showed VR
just
X-Wings, and it's like, oh, that's cool. You know, Star Wars is always fun, and dogfighting could be cool. It could. And then they also had a teaser of Rocksteady's new game. It's Batman for VR, but they didn't show anything. So
right.
No idea.
And Final Fantasy was even worse. It just didn't look right.
Yeah, that's what I heard.
Yeah, I don't know. It just keeps looking. That game looks like it's getting worse and worse and worse. It's like I just looked into it more. Like, at first it looked cool. Yeah. Like, I swear, their first demo, like, looked awesome. I don't remember.
That was the best one.
The first time they showcased it, like, was awesome. And then all of a sudden, it just keeps looking worse and worse.
Yeah, which is odd. I don't know quite what they're trying to do. And then it went into Call of Duty, and I don't know. I mean, they showed off a little bit of it at least. So what they showed looked better than the original trailer, so that's good. But I still need to see multiplayer. I mean, even if I see multiplayer, I'm honestly done with Call of Duty.
I'm
pretty excited for Battlefield 1, so I think a lot of people are going to be like that. And I'm not getting this
Call
of
Duty for once.
It might. That's still a pretty hard order. Yeah. And then they also talked about Crash, which I'm happy. I was pretty confident they were going to bring Crash back, and they are. Not in the way I wanted, though. They're remaking three of them, remastering them for the PS4. That's awesome.
The best three.
Yeah, that's awesome. But then they're also throwing him into Skylanders, which that's what they did to Spyro. Yeah, let's not
even talk about that.
And that's
I don't
just,
want to talk about that.
Yeah, that's just upsetting. That's not what we want for that character. But yeah, so at least I made that prediction right. I was guessing that was gonna happen. Well, at least that Crash was coming back. And then we've got this game, which it is probably the most hyped up game solely for two reasons. One, it's Hideo Kojima. And two,
here it comes.
The main actor is Norman Reedus.
He's butt naked.
It has nothing to do with the game itself because we don't know anything about the game itself.
No joke for sure. The trailer is him.
No joke for sure. It's a naked Norman Reedus.
Yes.
Holes, yes.
Holding a baby.
Holding what was a baby and then became like invisible and tar and I don't know what.
Because the conspiracy theories are already up in full.
This game hates me.
Because honestly, like, I understand Kojima like makes great games. I don't really play his games, but from what I hear, this guy is nuts. Like the things he thinks of,
that's putting
his storylines are insane and make no sense. I don't understand why he's so popular, honestly. Because I mean, again, I haven't played his games.
I do.
So...
I'm a Kojima fan.
Okay.
Yeah,
but,
no,
like,
me too. He does things you wouldn't expect, and he thinks outside the box.
He has a
That's
very artistic expression in his games. It's a certain style that he's known for.
Very.
And you
I would
gotta
have never
also
thought Metal
remember,
Gear would be interesting, and then look what happened.
You know, did you know, this is a little deep did you know fact, but did you know Hideo Kojima literally invented the stealth genre? Like, there was no such thing as stealth genre in video games before the original Metal Gear games on the NES. And he invented it. And so people were like, when he was being interviewed for this new game, they're like, well, what kind of game is it going to be? Is it going to be action, RPG, blah, blah, blah? He was like, oh, I don't know. I might be going towards a new genre again. And people were like,
he said
genre,
he doesn't even
fuck?
Know. Yeah, he doesn't even know what the gameplay engine's going to be.
And everyone's like, well, how can you make a new genre? And they're like, well, you do know he invented stealth genre before that was a genre. And people are like, oh.
Yeah, anyone can do it.
He deserves respect. Like,
I mean, to be honest, you could argue Bungie has kind of made a new... I guess not new genre exactly, but that whole semi-MMO thing, Bungie has really kind of done that with Destiny.
Oh, with Destiny?
With Destiny.
It's a first-person
so
shooter,
like,
though.
Things happen. Yeah, it's still a first-person shooter. Well, so
Destiny
is the stealth ones,
the
though.
Way that we're
They're still shooters.
At those kind of games now. I'll give them that.
But, I mean, so, yeah. Like, new genres are being invented every now and then. I mean, Paragon and Battleborn, you know, they're blending some genres. So, you know, things are...
Fusions. They're blending. They're not
they're fusions,
you know, inventing. Right?
Yeah, oh, yeah, but I'm just saying, like, we're getting new
he
things,
might that
so.
Could be what he's doing, because I can honestly I can't even begin to think of what a new genre could
but this
be.
This is
but you never know
this is definitely probably like 5 years
naked Norman
in the
simulator
making. Like this is gonna be a while before this game hits, but
yes, it could be
a lot of people are excited.
This is Last Guardian all over again,
2020.
But right. Then the game that I wish was on consoles that I knew Happy wouldn't be thinking of because he probably has not heard that this is a thing. I'm jealous that they're getting a Spider-Man game.
Yeah, I'm surprised they made that an exclusive. I don't see the purpose
very
of that.
Surprised
and I say that as a PS4 owner.
Yeah. I'm surprised.
Well, they do have the rights to
get the exclusive thing.
Well, they have the rights.
No, they have the rights to
cinematically.
The Spider-Man.
In the cinematic universe, but
even if they're making that deal with Marvel,
But I don't think that, there's no way Marvel would ever renew that, but I don't think Sony ever lost the rights to Spider-Man yet, so.
Well, no, they made a joint agreement.
They made a joint thing, but that's, they're not losing the rights for the cinematic universe. But,
I see.
But for video games, like, on the one is The Amazing Spider-Man 2, so clearly it's, like, recent Spider-Man games have been on both consoles, so it's weird that this one is exclusive. And this one looks like a finally a good one. Like, for the past several years and several iterations of Spider-Man games, they have not been very great. So...
Yeah, I would agree. And, you know, I think the last one I really liked really was Shattered company. Dimensions, and that was a long time ago.
Yeah, I did hear good things about that.
I remember that one.
But yeah, so this Spider-Man game, it could be fun, and I'd be kind of interested in it. But that's what I've got for PlayStation. Anyone got anything before I go to Nintendo? Nope. All right.
Ooh, so Nintendo.
Nintendo.
There's a lot to say about Nintendo.
We're gonna try to keep it shorter than they do for their
demos.
They
showed like two games.
Well, yeah, but they showed like a day of Zelda.
Think of it as a boxing match where this one person is like throwing a flurry of punches, blah 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 blah, and then the next person just punches you once and you fall down. That's kind of like what Nintendo did, in my opinion.
That's pretty good, actually.
It's just like one punch done.
Yeah, that's actually a really awesome analogy. That's if you're a Zelda fan. For me, I was, you know, just kind of like not really that interested.
I mean, don't
it
get me wrong,
cool,
I love Zelda,
but
I gotta play the other Zelda.
You have to be a Zelda. This game, the scope of it is
the scope is pretty awesome. Yeah,
yeah, I am really looking forward to it. I just wish that.
Even if you like didn't know what Zelda was, like I would want this game to be played by everyone. It just looks like, wow. The fact that it said it's completely open world, like you could beat the game if you so chose from the moment the first cutscene is over, like that kind of level
of
freedom.
Skyrim edition, basically.
Yeah, it's just wow.
Yeah. So.
And the maps look huge. Like that one, they were secluded to one segment of a map, and that map is like ginormous, and there's when they zoomed out all the way, that was like one of like I want to say maybe 20 segments, so who knows how truly big the world is.
We had a bunch of Zelda shown off, and it was all good and well received. It was awesome. We saw a little bit of Pokemon Sun and Moon. It was really cool.
They showed Go too.
Yep, but for Sun and Moon,
yeah, they did.
It was really cool to see that there's now a Battle Royale kind of mode where you can have four-way just free-for-all, and the way it works is whoever dies, once someone loses their Pokemon, then the game is over, and I guess it gets tallied on like who did the most damage and whatnot. And so looks really cool. That's, you know, completely new mode, something very new, and I'm very happy that they're doing something so different, because at least it's not the same game over and over again anymore. For the hardcore Pokemon fans, the character models are no longer the what do you call those, Chiblis? They're like
I think that's right. Chibi? Is it some sort of thing?
Chibi?
Yeah, I think it's Chibi, where the heads
now
are
like actual character models instead of like little stubby things.
Yeah, with giant heads.
So now the character models are normal. And for the first time ever, during the Pokemon battles, you see your trainer in the background.
It's about damn time.
And yeah, like it's a little thing that only like the Pokemon fans are really going to notice. But that's time. Like it is really cool. Mm-hmm. I like the layout of these battles. Looks awesome. The lower screen looks really cool too, because you know it's a two dual screen thing. So
yeah.
It looks cool. And so that's what I've got to say about that. It looked like a lot of fun. You know, if I was still a Pokemon player, I'd be very excited for this. I'm excited for it, and I'm not a Pokemon player.
Nice.
Pokemon Go, on the other hand, not that excited for, but you know, excited to see what kind of stuff happens. I don't find it to be a very practical game that people are going to love. I think only the super hardcore Pokemon fans are going to love it. But basically, you go around, you catch Pokemon, and they showed it off a little bit at E3. It uses augmented reality, which is a really cool technology that's been around for several years now that no one has really found a great way to take advantage of. And so yeah,
the handheld systems tried to use it a little bit, but they didn't go too far. PS Vita both tried.
They've tried and they have not been successful. And augmented reality, in my opinion, is really, really cool. And so I'm excited for when someone might finally do that correctly. I mean, possibly the Microsoft HoloLens will do that correctly, because you know, they're not trying to do virtual reality. They're going to wait a few years and then have the HoloLens do, like, augmented reality. And I think that will be really cool. But Pokemon Go, you know, go around, you catch Pokemon. It's going to encourage people to get off their butts and get out of the house, because you got to travel. That's one of the issues I have with it, is if you want to really get all these Pokemon, you got to go around the world. So
yeah, that's the thing. I don't want to go to like Jamaica just to catch Snorlax. Like,
yeah, that's not.
I don't know.
That's not something people are like. That's another practicality issue I have with this game, is like you're gonna get about 30 Pokemon, and you're gonna get like 30 Pokemon, and you're gonna, and you know, it's gonna be just like the game where you're walking around, and because in your town where you will always walk around, and you're just gonna get freaking Rattata, Zubat, you know, like Pidgey, like it's gonna be the same. It's gonna be the same like four Pokemon you're gonna see all 90% of your time. Also, something that I actually
they confirmed
did,
that actually.
Yeah. No, something like, I actually
like if
did.
You stay in one area, you're only going to get the same Pokemon.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, so that's a practicality issue that I have with this game, because it's cool, but and it makes sense.
But what if you are, like, a traveler? Like,
oh, then like, this is the game for you.
Yeah.
But you got to be a traveler.
Like, all 400 and whatever of them right away.
Yeah, if you're a traveler, this is the game for you. And a lot of people travel, especially like travel on business, you know, a lot of people travel. Yeah. So this is a game for a lot of people. But for the younger kids who are not like traveling on business, they're not going to be like, hey, mom, we got to go on like a Caribbean cruise in a week because I need to catch Gyarados.
Nope.
But yeah, like that's not happening.
I let my 5-year-old do that.
Picture the boss.
Shut up. Yeah.
Just picture the boss being like, take all the time you need.
I'm curious to see if they're going to do like some special event stuff, and like people are going to go frantic being like, I got to get into New York City by
God, I hope
three
not.
In 3 days.
I hope not.
So that I'm curious. Something.
When they showed like that stuff where like a Mewtwo like appeared in Times Square, like that kind of shit. Like,
yeah,
what if you don't live in New York? Those, how are you going to get that Mewtwo?
Yes,
well, I can imagine it being...
What you don't know is that their second plan of this is to open Pokemon Air, where it's an airline with premium tickets to these spots.
So it's like buying the DLC.
Yeah, there's the DLC.
It's
a freaking plane ticket.
Yeah, that's worth it for some little digital flip on your phone.
Something they did confirm, announce and confirm, which was really cool. I think it's really cool for their perspective and ours, is when this game launches, which, by the way, it's launching soon. It's supposed to be, like, by the end of July. It should be in the States. When it launches, it's going to be Gen 1. You're not going to be finding newer Gen Pokemon. And so they're going to slowly roll out the other regions area Pokemon and stuff.
That's what that is.
Which I think is great, because honestly, this will help keep you interested in the game for a longer period of time. Like, I understand people are going to be like, no, I want Lucario right now. Like, sorry, that sucks for you, but guess what? Now all these little kids, you're gonna learn today about Squirtle, Bulbasaur, and Charmander. So, like, you're gonna...
Well, it seems
I
fair,
like that
least.
It's gonna, you know, it's gonna give the nostalgia for the people like me who that was... We were around when Pokemon became a thing.
Yeah, I mean, that's the way to go.
It's gonna force the younger kids who didn't get to enjoy Red and Blue, and they're finally gonna be like, oh, wow, I don't really ever see Exeggutors. Like, what is this Pokemon? It's a freaking palm tree walking around. But I don't know if Exeggutor is even like a Pokemon anymore in these games. I don't know. So, like, that's why I use that as an example, because he was already like
not a very popular
Pokemon. So I just like chose him.
I think the last time it was probably White or Black too.
Yeah. But so anyway, that's I like that. Like I said, for more than anything, I like it because it will force you to have more interest in the game for a longer period of time without really punishing you. And so that I like that.
I was wondering if they were gonna like region lock it, like okay, maybe you know this first gen's gonna be on this continent and then we're just gonna have other continents, kind of like, you know, how whenever the second gen came out, it's a new region. I was wondering if they're going to do it region-based, like, you know, generation by region.
I don't think so.
Yeah.
They won't, Brian, I
gotta cut it short with me. I gotta head out, but good talking with y'all.
Have a good night.
Have a good night.
We're almost done here, guys. The problem with Nintendo having their presentation the way they do, they don't have like an actual conference. They just like throughout the day, we're going to show things. So I have missed things. I don't know what I missed. Does anyone know of any other Nintendo announcements? No. All right. Yeah. So I missed things. Cause I think I saw something about like a new Paper Mario Splash or something.
But I
didn't look into it, so I don't know what that is. There's some minor ones. There's nothing else major, but I feel like I've definitely missed some minor Nintendo.
So,
mm-hmm.
Yeah, I mean, there's little things. One thing is that they didn't talk about the NX, but they said they were going to talk about it. So, do you know what the date is of when they are going to discuss their new console?
No, it's going to be at a future Nintendo Direct. They haven't announced that yet. We just know it's going to be in the future Nintendo Direct.
So they haven't even announced when the Nintendo, because apparently it's supposed to come out this year, correct?
No, it comes out in March.
Is it been March? Oh, yeah, okay.
That is the slated date. Yeah, I would expect in the next 4 months we find out. But I don't know. Nintendo's weird. I've never understood their marketing, so I don't know. But then a few things that were at E3 that didn't have, major coverage, and they weren't part of a conference, but they were still at E3, were Mafia 3 had a pretty big presence backstage, basically. A lot of people got to see more about that. Mafia 3 looks like a lot of fun. Mafia 2 was a phenomenal game, so... I'm excited for Mafia 3.
I never played it. Hopefully they'll have Mafia. They'll
did you
do
never
with
play Mafia 2
right now. I know it was free to play.
Yeah, did you get it when it was
I
free?
Never got to download it. No,
oh my God,
I wanted to.
You missed out. Just
it was
buy
such a downer.
Happy, get a pre-owned one from GameStop and then like return it in the week. But like play it.
I don't
like,
want to dirty
Happy,
myself.
Happy, it's so good.
GameStop.
Yeah, shut up. You know what? You got pre-owned games at your crappy store, so go do that then.
I don't think we'll have Mafia 2. We don't have that great of a selection.
Yeah, I know you don't.
Not for pre-owned. No one knows that we do trade-ins. Like, it's just, yeah. I mean, they see the pre-owned games, but they must think we get them out of there and they don't want to offer them.
They probably think you buy
them. Or is there two? exactly.
But you really should play that game. It was so good. And honestly, like, the ending, like, if they remastered Mafia 2, I don't want to have to go through that ending again. I don't think I would ever get by it again. I don't want to play that game again because of how powerful the ending was.
too powerful for it was too emotional.
I don't like, oh my gosh, I don't even, I'm moving on, I don't want to think about that. It was so good. I can't think about it. I don't want to say anything.
Oh my god.
But it's just so good, Happy.
I imagined it was going to be a good game.
Another game that did get announced, it was one of those background things at E3. I don't think it was even shown it on any conferences last year, but it was a background game at last year's E3 and again this year E3. And I think it's actually going to be a good game. I think it's going to be one of those sleeper games that it's good, but not groundbreaking or phenomenal, and so it's not a sleeper title that becomes a hit. It's going to be a sleeper title that was a good game but never really becomes anything. I'm talking of Technomancer.
Never heard of it.
Yeah, exactly. No one's ever heard of it. I don't think a single person on my friends list has probably ever heard of it. I don't know how I want to describe it. I almost want to describe it like a, it reminds me of a Force Unleashed game, but not Star Wars. And like maybe like a Mad Max meets a Force Unleashed. I don't know how I want to describe that.
I have Mad Max. I haven't played it though. But that was a game that I got on a whim. That was Black Friday.
Technomancer is worth like taking a look at it. I don't know. It looks like it could be cool. I think I would like to try it at some point. I'm definitely not gonna like buy it full price or anything, but if I could try it out at some point, that I wouldn't be upset. I was very, very happy to see, even though it didn't get talked about really on stage, on PlayStation and Microsoft's conferences, they both showed a little bit of Yooka-Laylee. And I was very happy about that. Yooka-Laylee is a game that I have been pushing on people for a very long time. The only game I have ever backed on a Kickstarter. Only Kickstarter I have ever backed. Yooka-Laylee, basically the spiritual successor to Banjo-Kazooie, starring a chameleon and a bat. And I'm very excited for that. And so I can imagine that will get a lot of press next year's E3. Similar to Sea of Thieves.
Hey, when is Yooka-Laylee supposed to come out? Is it 2017?
It's a 2017 game. Most games this E3 are 2017 games. I feel like this was very much a 2017 year for many.
Yeah,
of the
games. I don't. What is coming out 2016? Like, there's really.
There's still. I mean, Recore is coming out this year. Gears is coming out this year. Battlefield, Call of Duty, Forza Horizon. South Park, Dead Rising, maybe Tekken. I don't remember about Tekken.
Just not a lot of games I'm into, so that's fine.
There's still a good lineup for this year, but yeah, a lot of what they showed was also for last year. Cuphead, which is still getting just a lot of attention, which is great. Which is why I said it could definitely be sold for $30. But no real conference about it, no real talk about it. Just people are playing it. They showed off some more boss levels. Everyone always keeps saying it's a great game, they love it, but we don't know much about it. Lego Dimensions had their trailer leak thing pre E3. And, you know, that's cool. They're adding a bunch of characters and stuff. It looks fun, including Sonic. Destiny actually was talking with some people about Rise of Iron. They didn't explain a lot, but Destiny did go over a few things. And then another game that I'm excited for, Friday the 13th. This is the last thing that I have written down to talk about. But Friday the 13th looks... Oh, no problem. Have a good night. Friday the 13th looks a lot of fun. That is basically... It looks like kind of
Evolve
meets Naughty Bear.
More like not combat, but more hide and seek.
Yeah. Yeah, I still haven't figured out like how the campers are supposed to win. But
well, they're supposed cool. to no, they're supposed to be able to leave the island.
Oh yeah, right, yeah, you're right.
There's ways off the island and they have to escape. That.
So they have to escape, and it's just, it sounds really cool. The little gameplay I saw, like, it genuinely...
Is that coming out this year or no?
I don't think so, no. It seems like there's still a lot of development for that game. But it genuinely is horrifying when you're a camper and you're trying to set up and you look out the window and you just see Jason standing there. They showed that in one scene and I was like, holy crap, this is like a horror movie. It was, and I will be doing that, and I'm sure you guys will probably do that too. Just like psychologically messing with these people is gonna be great.
Yeah.
But they also had some cool mechanics. Like I watched, like as a camper, you could like turn on the radio so that he doesn't really hear you moving around, and so that was a cool feature. I saw like. Someone was setting up and they opened up the window, I guess, to make it so they could get out faster if they need to. So they were making some escape routes. And so, a lot of fun stuff. Hopefully that game will do really well because it's cool. And I want a horror game to do really well. I loved Naughty Bear, but that game didn't take off because it was teddy bears and people got confused. But games like that are a lot of fun. Does anyone have anything else to say? Because I'm done.
That was a productive conversation.
Yeah. Like every now and then, people have joined the stream. They're like, "Are you gonna play Ori?" And I'm like, "No, sorry, just talking E3. I just use this for a beautiful background and soundtrack." which makes me feel like I should stream some Ori because I've gotten like 6-7 viewers every now and then for this stream, and I'm like, I'm sorry, I'm not even trying to stream Ori, I'm just talking about E3.
Okay.
But yeah, I feel like I should stream Ori, but I don't really want to. I'm just gonna sidetrack right now. I got frustrated today. I'm trying to get all the collectibles for Ori. I can't find a couple of them. I hate that in this game they didn't make it so that every collectible is shown on the minimap. There are some that do not show on minimaps. And so I can't find some of them. Like on some places I'm at 99%. And I searched YouTube. I was like, all right, just give me the answers. And the videos were not helpful. Like I watched the videos and I'm like, well, I got everything you got. How come I'm not there? So that drove me insane. So I'm frustrated with Ori right now. But that's my side.
I got all the collectibles earlier.
Yeah, I think you did. You got it on the first. I was never able to do it. That is the achievement that I have never gotten with this game. Because
I've never done the one life thing. That thing is
impossible. Oh, I never got that either. I didn't even attempt that. Because that's not... To me, that's not even going to be fun. Because what that means is you've got to do a lot of... Oh, quick, I just died. I need to press start, quit the game before it saves. And, like, that's not how I want to play a game. You know, I did the speedrun one, and that one was fun. You know, just go as fast as you can and do it under 3 hours. And I was able to do that. And that did involve some quitting and restarting. But one life one is going to do a... It's not going to be that fun.
Yeah, a lot of memorization, and that game has a lot of curveballs when it comes to killing you.
Yep, like, you know, and it's got some areas with
fine
the spikes.
And something like splats you.
Yeah, and like the spikes will just one hit you. And so, yeah, this game can be hard for some of the achievements. They are no joke. But I'm gonna end this broadcast.